So this recording is going to be available on the center's YouTube channel. So you can find it there after, probably this afternoon after we conclude. In terms of our schedule for this morning, we're gonna do a little bit of welcome. I'll do some introductions. Dr. Greg Kuhn is gonna kick us off with government structures, and we're gonna take a little bit of a short break in there. I'm going to come back and talk more specifically about nonprofit advocacy. And then I'm very excited that we'll have a panel discussion with some nonprofit managers on this topic to give their perspective on what they do in their organizations. And then hopefully we'll leave some time at the end for Q&A and a little bit of wrap up. So a little bit about the center. We're really glad that you're here. This is one of our first programs of the year that we're offering. The Center for Nonprofit and NGO Studies here at Northern Illinois University is now 10 years old. We're into our 11th year. And really we have three areas. One is our academic programs. So we have undergraduate, major, minor, and certificate in nonprofit and NGO studies, an interdisciplinary program here at Northern. We also do research. We have joint faculty as well as associated faculty that do a lot of research about the nonprofit and NGO sector. And then we pride ourselves in doing community engagement. And community engagement means both for our students, they are heavily involved in internships, study abroad, service courses, community engagement, all kinds of things at the course level, but then also our faculty. We do a lot of consulting, applied research projects, and we have a number of those underway right now. So if you're interested in anything that we can assist you with, please reach out anytime. You'll also find us on all of our social media channels. So as I said, the recording of this will be on YouTube. We're also on Instagram, LinkedIn, and Facebook, so you can always find us there. We have some upcoming programs in February that you might be interested in. On Monday, we have a program on LGBTQ philanthropy with Dr. Elizabeth Dale coming to us from the University of Texas. And she's gonna talk about her research, as well as on February 3rd, we'll have our NNGO networking extravaganza. And that's really for our students and nonprofit professionals and our alums to get together. It's a virtual setting. So if you're able to attend, that's the evening of February 3rd. And you'll find all of our events and our programs on the homepage of our website, but all of our social media channels as well. One of our joint faculty members, Dr. Mark Schuler, just published a book called Humanity's Last Stand, and he'll be doing a book presentation on February 9th. And then we kick off our spring Real Talk Big Ideas with an informal discussion between an academic researcher as well as a nonprofit professional. And so our February talk is about nonprofit finance. Dr. Elizabeth Searing will be coming to us, as well as Delilah Allegra from the Inc. Board in Aurora. And they do a lot of working with townships in Kane County to deliver mental health and behavioral health services in that community. February 23rd is our use of data for grant proposals with Sherry Taylor from the Center for Governmental Studies. So if you are writing grants or you know someone in your organization that's doing grants, this should be a great presentation for you to attend. So I wanna kick us off with our first speaker, Dr. Greg Kuhn, who's the interim director of the Center for Nonprofit and NGO Studies. Greg has over 20 years of experience in local government, a number of municipalities he's worked in, and then we've been fortunate to have him here at CGS. And I always put Center for Nonprofit and NGO Studies, Greg. He's at the Center for Governmental Studies. I'm so used to writing our center. Maybe there's a default. So he's been at the center now. He's now interim director there, and they do a lot of consulting with local governments, and he's done a number of these presentations for their Civic Leadership Academy, as well as consulting. So let me stop sharing there for a second, and I will turn it over to Greg to share his screen.
Thank you, Alicia.
It's always Center for Nonprofit and NGO Studies, Greg. I always want to claim you, I guess.
I was like, I have another new job. Anyway, good morning. Let me get my screen sharing set up, everybody. It's good. Good to be with you. Look to the good professor to give me a thumbs up that you can see my PowerPoint.
You're good. See you. Perfect.
Good. And you confused me at first because when your slides came up because of the template, I was like, how did Alicia get my slides? So anyway, you can tell Alicia and I are not only colleagues, she's a good friend. I consider her a good friend and a great partner in a lot of things. So thank you for inviting me today. Also at some risk, when the good professor invited me to be part of this presentation, and I have to give Alicia credit. It was a few months ago, so you know, planning ahead is a good thing. But I said, Alicia, you want me to talk about government? I can go an entire semester. I mean, so, you know, beware. I could go 16 weeks. I can go 8 weeks. But I love this topic. It's been my career. It's been my life's work. So if I get a little passionate as we go along, it's because I really do feel this is a noble calling. And I think we need more civic reinforcement training and education rather than less. And we'll see if you take something away today that gives you some help as you navigate this idea about advocacy and representing either your organization, your industry, or the work that you are particularly focused on. All right, so an introduction and an overview of governmental structures in the US, and I'm gonna have a little bit of an emphasis also on local governments, because that is the unit of government that most of us engage with most frequently, et cetera. And you see, I have a nice collection of governmental buildings, and for those that are around our hometown of DeKalb, there you have the State of Illinois Capitol in Springfield at the top. At the bottom left is the DeKalb County Courthouse in Sycamore, the rotunda of the U.S. Capitol, and then what is now the former City Hall for the city of DeKalb. But that's a nice, what we call archive picture from 1968 of that building. All right, so also at some risk, Alicia will appreciate this. We cannot have a class without a quiz. So I thought the way to get everybody awake on a Friday morning is, really? Did this guy actually have a quiz for us? And yes, I do. So here it is, all right? The first question I'm gonna put to you is, did the federal government create the states? This is the United States context, okay? So I have to leave my good friend from Canada there. Of course, she's kind of equally comfortable in both sides of the border. But did the federal government in the United States create the states, or did the states create the federal government? Does anybody want to weigh in there and offer a response? Are you going to be brave?
Go ahead and put your answer into the chat.
No, any responses? Oh, here they go. I see.
Yeah, can you see it, Greg? Because I can read them too.
I can only see how many are in there. So if you just shout them out.
So states, looks like we have a lot of answers. States created the federal government. A convention of states created the federal government. I think we're all going with states created the federal government.
All right. You already get an A. You have your first A of the semester. So, you know, I have asked this question for as long as I've been teaching. I mean, this goes back to my days when I came back to school to work on my doctoral studies, and a lot of seminars, as Alicia mentioned, and I've had the opportunity to teach a seminar like this. These days, I would say easily, you know, approaching 800 to 900 officials from China over the years, the last 20 years that I've had a chance to work with. So you're absolutely right. It is the states that created the federal government in the United States. And that is a framework that's important for all of us to keep in mind. Oops, and my PowerPoint is not advancing. All right, so I think this is exactly what I was hoping for. Come up next, sorry about that. So let's just start there. The states, created the federal government, and that was in response to the first governing model we had after the American Revolution. And we're going to revisit that a little more in a few more slides. But let me just make something local. For the weekend, again, if you're looking for trivia, A, you're welcome to use that quiz. There's no royalties involved. You can run that by your friends and family. How about this one? All right, if anyone on the session today is from Illinois, grew up in Illinois, lives in Illinois, visited Illinois, has read about Illinois. I would say that lately our news headlines aren't always the greatest. Illinois is losing population. We're going to lose at least one seat in Congress. But here's something that Illinois is number one in. All right. I want you to know Illinois stands above everyone else in this statistic. We have more units of local government in Illinois than any other state in the nation. Pennsylvania comes in second. All right. So we are the land of Lincoln. Sure. But we're also the land of local government. 6,963 units of local government in Illinois. There's an asterisk. I'll explain that in a minute. 102 counties. That hasn't changed for a long time. 12,998 municipalities, 870 school districts, 3,200 special purpose districts, approximately, reason for that, and 1,431 townships. There you go. And I want you to think about this slide when we return to this parts of this subject a few more times in the next hour. Why are there asterisks on this sheet? Over my career, including once or twice a year, I go and dig around, where can I find an accurate count of how many of these units of local government there are in Illinois? And can I tell you, you go to different sources, most of them will not agree. They will agree on 102 counties, that I can assure you. The 6,900, 6,700-ish units of local government, you can find that number a lot of places. But when it gets down to the nitty-gritty, this is a floating number, and I think it's one of the most amazing things. You can go to various sources, and here's the one little technicality. Every unit of government has to have a charter, and it's supposed to be recorded with the Secretary of State. So I'm kind of confused why we don't know, but I'm giving you the best that I got, okay? So we are number one. In Illinois, you know, it is a large state. And for those of you that have traveled from north to south or east to west, I mean, you can come across so much in the state of Illinois. I grew up south of DeKalb, about 50 miles out in near Ottawa, Illinois. You know, the flat prairie, the good, you know, dark earth and corn and soybean territory and all that. But, you know, you get toward the Mississippi River, you go up to Galena, and one of our children, one of our daughters ended up going to law school at Southern, and you go down to Southern Illinois and the Shawnee National Forest, it's beautiful. And you go, am I really in the same place? So we cover a lot of territory, and obviously Chicago and the metro region. So just for example, you say, okay, Greg, that's really interesting. We're the land of local government. So kind of what does this look like locally? So I'm just using the lens of DeKalb for a little bit of a case study here. Here are the government jurisdictions at the local level. If you live in DeKalb, Illinois, these are the units of local government that are taking care of you. The county, DeKalb Township, the city of DeKalb, the DeKalb Public Library, the DeKalb School District, the DeKalb Park District, the DeKalb Sanitary District, and Kishwaukee Community College. So if you want to feel like you've got government at your fingertips, I'm going to say, absolutely, pick one. Go visit them, call them, email them, visit their website. I mean, this is just one slice, one community in Illinois. And this is how we get to that number of 6,900 and so units of local government. And you know, part of it is we became really good at something in Illinois, and that was creating units of local government. All right, so before we got to Illinois today and all those units of government in DeKalb, you know, you might ask yourself, well, help me, Greg, let's retrace, how did we get here? All right, so just as a little refresher, some of these things might be familiar, there might be a few you forgot and some you never saw. 1776, all right, that's an easy one, right? Declaration of Independence. We fought the Revolutionary War, the British surrendered, and in 1781, we figured, hey, we need a way to run this country we just created. I know what we're gonna do. Let's have these Articles of Confederation. And basically the Articles of Confederation are how we functioned until 1789 when the Constitution was ratified. And that was not a very good form of government, I'll just say. And I get students in class on this one too. It's my second kind of zinger quiz question. You know, has the US always functioned under the current Constitution? And most students say, oh yeah, and I go, oh no. And I just want to point out that what didn't work about it, but it's reflected in what they did create later and what we all live with and experience today, is one of the first things, one of the most fundamental values in the United States form of government all the way through is this idea of local government, local governance, self-governance, and weak central government. Remember, they won a revolution against a monarch, and they did not want an autocratic one single point of power, and you'll see examples of that. So their first form of government was definitely a reflection of that. The Articles of Confederation was basically a treaty between 13 sovereign states. And yes, they said they had an army, and yes, they said they were a country, and yes, they said this, but the problem was no state wanted to send money. At the time, the capital was New York. No one wanted to send money to the central government. Nobody wanted to fund an army. Nobody wanted to staff an army. We had different currencies across all 13 states, and states were taxing each other. Oh, that was exciting. That was really good. Well, they figured out in short order, that's not working. And now with the popularity of Hamilton and, kind of bringing to fore a little bit of the birth of our Constitution and our history during this time, they created a whole new form of government that didn't exist anywhere on the planet, nowhere. Our democracy was the first in the world. I call them these crazy philosophers, came up with this plan, and you'll see a little more of its architecture here in a couple more slides. So 1776, the Declaration, 1781, the Articles of Confederation, nice try, didn't really work so well. 1783, the end of the Revolutionary War, the Treaty of Paris. 1787, the Northwest Territory Act. Hey, you're sitting in the Northwest Territory. there's a few things, like there's a school in Evanston named after this and a few other things. But the Northwest Territory, they kind of staked out this little piece of earth a long, long time ago. 1789, the U.S. Constitution was adopted and ratified. And local here, closer to home, 1809, Kaskaskia was named the capital of the territory of Illinois, not the state of Illinois. A few more years to go. 1818, Illinois was granted statehood. We were the 21st state to join the Union. 1819, the Illinois capital moved from Kaskaskia to Vandalia. Another one of those real estate moves that was interesting all by itself. 1833, a little place called Chicago was first identified as a town. In 1870, the Illinois Constitution halted special charters that used to be issued for municipalities and townships. And beginning in 1870, all municipalities in Illinois had to come under the provisions of the Cities and Villages Act, and you'll get a little glimpse of that. So, you say, well, how do we get here? Just remember, we're all a product of a whole bunch of decisions, a whole lot of debate and public policy and a little bit of invention along the way. All right, so here's something that might be familiar to many of you. I start many of my classes by reading this. We the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America. So that's the preamble to that document that isn't all that long. It really isn't. What it took to create it, there was a lot more writing that went into the Federalist Papers to support it than the actual document itself, and a lot of debate. But let's visit this a little more. So what was the architecture that was at work for them? And the reason I'm sharing all this, and again, I give a little nod of Alicia's either faith or confidence in me, is that I really believe if you're gonna interact with the government and try to do it in a meaningful way, understanding how it's built and how it works and its philosophical underpinnings are important, because the stuff that's here today just didn't land here out of a spaceship. It was all a series of decisions, and there's a lot of reasons for it. And sometimes it's part of the frustration of trying to work with government. All right, so let's look at this American federal system that was built. Again, this was an invention. It existed nowhere on the planet Earth. They looked at a lot of readings, and us political scientists will point you to the three most influential philosophers were people by the names of Hobbes, Locke, and Rousseau, but there were a lot of other writings. But what were they looking for? They wanted a decentralized government. And they wanted the authority of government and the jurisdictions to be divided, all right? They didn't want that central one core like a monarch. So how did they divide it? They divided it between a national form of government, level of government, state governments, and then the states created local governments. And we'll visit that a little more later. There's only two levels of government recognized in the Constitution: the nation, right, the federal government, and the states. And you already aced the quiz, so you're halfway there. But you know, this idea of fragmentation starts to emerge here because, you know, the answer is it was the states that created the federal government. And whatever's not identified or specifically spelled out in the Constitution or the amendments to the Constitution and the Bill of Rights, all powers that are not specifically delegated to the federal government are retained by the states. And that's why the states in our system, both philosophically and legally, they retain sovereignty. Any amendments to the Constitution have to be ratified by 2/3 of the states, et cetera, et cetera. So, okay, we divided government authority. First of all, we have a federal government. The states said, okay, we're going to create this on behalf of all of us, but you can only do what we say you can do. Everything else we retain for ourselves. And then they decided, okay, well, let's split it up a little further. Let's divide authority across three branches of government. And I know this, some of you, this is like a trip down memory lane, right? The things we learned in elementary school, then again in middle school or junior high, and then in high school. But it's all very important to understand where and when to interact with the government. So we have authority distributed across three branches, all right? We have the executive branch, which most people identify with pretty readily, the governor's office in the state of Illinois, the mayor's office in the city, the county board chair, the school board chair, the president of the United States. But really, we're built around the legislative branch. The legislative is what they call the first branch. And at the federal level in the United States, they weren't even satisfied by having a legislative, executive, and then the third branch is judicial. No, that wasn't quite enough. We took the legislative branch and we split that in two. All right, so you're gonna continue to see this splitting and splitting and splitting. And, you know, come on, these physicists have nothing on political scientists. They split atoms, we split governments. All right, so two layers thus far, state, federal, three branches, all right? And what does this mean? Federal, if you look at a lot of definitions of federal government, it's all about shared power. That's the underlying framework here. So our federal system, you know, was designed to help govern a country that is diverse and where the states retained significant sovereignty and say in what happens. All right, so here's our visual of what I'm trying to describe. The three branches, executive, legislative, and judicial, and then the three levels of government, federal, state, and local. And we know there's local government. We see it, we touch it, it interacts with us every day. If anyone got up this morning, if you brushed your teeth, took a shower, flushed a toilet, drove in a street, walked on a sidewalk, that's local government. If your garbage got picked up, if your snow was plowed or coming up this weekend, we're gonna need them out there again, that's local government. But in our model, local governments are subsets of the state, and we'll revisit that some more in a few minutes. But if you look at the graph here, we have three levels of government: federal, state, local. And then we have three branches: executive, legislative, judicial. And that model holds consistent for all three levels. We have all three branches represented. And having to eliminate an entire semester course on this, we could go through each one of those squares and we'll hold it off for a minute. We'll touch on some of them as we go. All right, so why three levels? It's about purposefully fragmenting and diversifying decision-making and policy-making, right? And this is so fundamental to what we are as a country and to what, you know, frustrates the heck out of a lot of us, I think, as citizens sometimes. And if you've ever been trying worked on solving a problem and you get bounced around and they say, oh, maybe you call the city hall. Oh no, that's a county issue. And you go to the county and they say, well, actually the county's not taking care of that. That's the sanitary district. Oh, all right. And then you might get routed in another issue, you know, to the state government, or you might get routed to the school district, and it varies across 50 states. So our system of government was developed to control and limit the power of the central government, which would be our national government. So all 50 states retained sovereignty, as I mentioned a few minutes ago, except those powers that were granted by the states to the federal government. So what are the principles that frame our federal system? Fragmentation, a limited central government, this idea of checks and balances. So we have these three branches with the judiciary primarily serving as at the federal level, primarily, not exclusively, as a referee on what's happening between the levels of government or what's happening with federal law, federal statutes, et cetera. They're part of the checks and balances, the executive and the legislature. And I'm gonna pause here just for a minute. And I don't have a quiz for this one. And Alicia, because of time, I was so tempted. I wanted to have Schoolhouse Rock, but it's a 5-minute clip. But I wanna tell you that both in undergrad and grad classes I've taught, I am not shy to play this wonderful episode of Schoolhouse Rock. And it's called I'm a Sorry, am I back? Okay. The little Schoolhouse Rock piece, I just want to pause here for a second to reinforce one other idea about this form of checks and balances and how fervently the founders, this sense, this form of government they created, how they wanted to make sure that one branch or one part of the government could not just unilaterally, you know, act on its own and make significant changes. So if you have a chance, look up the Schoolhouse Rock piece on I'm a Bill, but I just want to share this. One thing that a lot of people forget is in the United States, they have a piece of legislation adopted is no small chore. I mean, it's in many ways, I've said for years, it's a miracle that anything ever gets adopted, because here's the fundamental, without going into a whole nother a day on this specifics here, but the basic premise is this. If the House of Representatives, you know, starts a bill and the idea is, okay, we want to start a program or we want to adopt a budget. And remember, there's all kinds of rules within the House and the Senate in the US, but just at the strategic level, the House adopts a bill on something. They have to send it to the Senate. Then the Senate has to adopt the bill. And then that is what would go to the president to be signed. So let's just do checks and balances real quick here. That piece of legislation that the House of Representatives, and by the way, it works the same in most of the states, a piece of legislation in the House, it gets sent to the Senate. The Senate can do whatever it wants with it, can turn it down, or as we've learned, they don't even have to take it up. They just let it sit there in a locker somewhere. Or if they take it up and debate it, before it becomes a law, before it can even go to the president, it has to be identical from both chambers. I mean, down to the commas, the paragraphs, the sentences, the chapter headings, the periods, it has to be identical. And so what's happened many times in the system they set up is, okay, the House passed it. They want to address something. Let's just say, you know, they want, strawberry milkshakes for everyone. And then the Senate says, well, I think strawberry milkshakes for everyone is a good idea, but I don't like the way you propose it in the House. So we're going to write our own strawberry milkshake legislation. And now you have two things on the same topic, but they're not the same. So they have to be reconciled. And you might've heard this, but you have to go to reconciliation committees, conference committees. That's where there's a lot of power in the legislative branch, because the Speaker of the House and the Senate Majority Leader gets to appoint the members of that committee. It's bicameral. And then they have to work on it. And if they come up with the same exact legislation, again, down to the paragraph, the sentence, the periods, the commas, everything has to be identical. If they both chambers have to re-vote on the new one, then if they do, it goes to the president. And the president has three choices, right? Sign it, it becomes law, veto it, or they can do a pocket veto, which is kind of ignore it. And anyway, we've seen a lot of that at work in the last few months, right before our eyes. Okay, so that's part of the checks and balances. And why did they want to do this? One of the things they were concerned about was protecting the interest of minorities, okay? And not minorities in the sense that we would use in some demographic definition. What they felt was minority points of view. And there's a lot of writings on this. All right, so I already covered state sovereignty. States get to run their own affairs. So anybody here on the class, if you've moved from state to state, has anyone ever moved from, Wisconsin to Illinois? What's one of the obligations? You have to get a new driver's license. I mean, when I talk to students, and I've had, like Alicia mentioned, we have students from abroad often, and or visitors, professionals that come for training and classes. And they go, if you live in Wisconsin, I moved to Illinois, I have to get a new license? Uh-huh. Oh, and by the way, if you're an engineer in Wisconsin and you want to be an engineer in Illinois, and now there have been some reciprocity agreements the last decade or two, but most professions, if you want to be a doctor, a dentist, an architect or something in one state, you have to go to the next state. You have to get a license in that state. You have to find in and pass their credentialing, blah, blah, blah. All right. So the whole system is boiled down to, you know, more local decision-making, more control at the areas that are in our own backyard. Oh, there we go. All right. So what does this look like? Here we go. Three levels of government in the US, one national or federal government, 50 states, probably would get an A on that quiz too. But we have about 90,000 units of local government across the United States. That includes counties, townships, cities, and special districts. And there you go. I thought it's time for a visual break, right? You've been listening to me. There is the United States of America in color. All the counties that are represented in the United States are shown on this map. And just remember, those are just counties. And now within those counties, we have school districts, townships, municipalities, drainage districts, et cetera, et cetera. But it's a little bit different view. And I have another map that's in black and white a little later. But you know, you'll see just interesting patterns if you just look at this for a minute. As you get further west, look at the size of some of those counties. And I've done some work in Arizona, in Maricopa County, and I was working with the library there, and I remember the library director was telling me how much time and money they spent trying to get books from one branch library to the other, and a county that's that size in mountainous terrain, it was, you know, things you don't think about. I mean, running the DeKalb Library, you don't have to worry about that. Yes, we have trying to get circulation going, but anyway, this is all a reflection of us, our geography, and sometimes in each state, you know, a little bit of the political philosophy of each state. All right, so where does local government fit in into these three levels? Local governments help represent both the diversity of views and local preferences. And again, we walk around every day, and this is something I think a lot of us just kind of take for granted. Well, yeah, I'm going to tell them what I want. And, you know, Sycamore wants this, DeKalb wants this, Cortland wants that, Maple Park wants this, go down Sandwich and Waterman want that, Ottawa wants this, Naperville wants that. I mean, they are a reflection of our local preferences. The idea is that it provides a sense of efficiency of having those preferences expressed at the local level, at the service that's closest to the citizen. Okay, now there are disagreements about this. I don't want to say, I want you to take away and go, oh, I heard Greg say that. I mean, there are different models of local government across the 50 states. There are people that would disagree with this and say we should have one unitary government at the local level. And there are places in the United States where this happens. I think some of you would recognize the phrase Miami-Dade, right? That's the city of Miami and Dade County. Well, it's a unified government. Many years ago, I did work in Chesapeake, Virginia. Well, that's a unitary government. They combined a city and a county there. You could go, there are other examples. Indianapolis is another example. There's an example in Tennessee. So there are different views on this, but primarily it's about getting those local preferences expressed through local officials, local governments. So how does local government look in the US? I gave you that broad number a little while ago. There's 3,031 counties. That's what you saw on that nice pretty map. About 36,000 almost municipalities or township governments. That's a whole nother, there'd be a whole nother afternoon of explanation between the difference between a township and a municipality, but let's leave it at that for today. And a little over 38,000 special districts. And, you know, special districts or anything in Illinois, we would recognize them as park districts, library districts, fire protection districts, drainage districts, sanitary districts, et cetera. And across the country, though, there are about almost 13,000 independent school districts. And again, that school district model that we know in Illinois so well, it is not universal. I mean, if you went to Virginia or the Carolinas, you're going to find local schools being primarily administered at the county level. So it's a whole different thing. All right. Why three levels of government? To accommodate this crazy invention of democracy, right? To provide checks and balances, to facilitate decision-making by elected representatives at federal, state, and local levels. And then the question is, I addressed a little bit my remarks a minute ago, why local units of government? The idea is let's push decision-making down. Let's get it as close as we can to the citizens, all right? And that helps account for our diversity of views, our diversity of economic and demographic situations and preferences. And also the idea is, well, it's more efficient to provide a localized service with those preferences expressed by policymakers that are very close to the citizens themselves. And, you know, you can't get much closer to yourself as someone who's on the school board or the city council or the village board or school board, something like that. All right, so a little bit of data. So, we've got all this government stuff, and some of you, you know, depending on how much reading and how closely you monitor some of this stuff, for many, many decades, the great debate in the U.S. is, oh my gosh, there's so many government workers. There's so many government workers, right? Because, you know, come on, everybody this morning, the first thing you did is you got up and you wrote a check to your local government because you were just happy they were there, right? I mean, you said they're not getting enough money, right? So let's just send more. Well, you know, so that turns into, you know, all these government employees, my gosh, my taxes are high and et cetera, et cetera. Yeah, yes, our taxes are part of our everyday living. There's no doubt about it. So here's what the workforce looks like. In the federal government level, there's about 4 million employees. 2 million are civilian, about 1.4 million are uniformed military, 580,000 are postal workers. I should put an asterisk there. Some people take postal workers completely out of the government equation. I don't know, I'm a traditionalist. I leave it in there, and most people do. But just by reflection, we have about 33,000 in the federal judicial branch across the United States. And you start to see scale of numbers. There aren't many in the judicial branch. How about state governments? There are about 5 million state government workers across the United States, and local government workers, there's about 14.8 million. You can find a lot of different places and ways to look at this information. Again, you're gonna find variances, I'll tell you that in advance, but the Bureau of Labor Statistics and the Office of Management and Budget and OPM, which is the Office of Personnel Management, a lot of good numbers there, but they fluctuate and their accuracy, I think you always have to take them with a little bit of grain of salt, but this is generally what you're gonna find in terms of government employment. One thing I wanna make note of before I go to the next slide, state government and local governments, in both of those categories, usually it's around 50 to 60% of those jobs are in education. Something related to education, higher education, elementary ed, et cetera. It depends on the state, depends on how they slice and dice it, but a good portion of workers at state and local level are related to some kind of educational mission. All right, so to preview, or I suppose better phrased, to respond to the thought I just put out there a few minutes ago, boy, there's so many government employees. This is just, they're like taking over the world, right? Well, when you show a graph like this, you start saying to yourself, holy cow. So what's on the left? 1940. So that is during World War II. And you can see there's a little bit of a pretty steep slope in the count of employees during and after World War II. And a little bit of a dip. And then you see this steady, steady rise until we get to the current period. And you see a sharp drop off of the current circumstances, but this is from the Federal Reserve. But this is an interesting track of government employment over time. And I don't know how, when you look at this, if you say to yourself, I knew it. I knew there were too many of them. But the thing is, remember, as a country, our population has changed significantly, right? But why did they pick 1940? This is the period of time that most political scientists and other observers of government would say that's when the modern government era began. Because prior to the Great Depression and World War II, government employment, I mean, there were government servants, but there weren't many. But it was in response to the Depression and response to the war that the view of government and what government role should be in society, you know, changed. And we've been on this kind of steady path ever since. And you can kind of see since 2010 or 9, which would have been our previous financial crisis, things have kind of leveled off, et cetera. So I'm not going to leave you just hanging with this chart and say, I knew it. They're just growing like crazy. Remember, our population today is almost 330 million. And gosh, I should know it. But in 1940, let's put it this way, was not 330 million. But the question then is always, well, what's the ratio, right? What's the percentage of government employees, you know, to the rest of us? And this is a nice look, some data that the Hamilton Project put together, but this goes back to 1980. In 1980, we were close to almost 10% of the workforce was employed in some kind of government employment. You see it dipped in 84. What's that reflecting? Big changes during the Reagan era, what became known as New Federalism. A lot of the grant programs, direct funding, a lot of other things, just the size of the federal government shrunk. And if you're a history fan or studied anything about that period of time or Reagan's administration, it's a reflection of the philosophy at the time. Then we had kind of a slow, kind of a climb back up, kind of leveled off. And then you can see from 2010, with the financial crisis, government employment has gone down because government jobs were eliminated, revenue shortages. And there has also been an advance, and Professor Shadman recognizes this and has helped teach this. There was a new look at how we provide services. And some of those services are represented by the organizations you're all part of. Part of this, both Reagan's new federalism and what's happened since 2010 was asking the non-governmental sector to take and see if they're interested in providing those services by contract or by providing those services outright. And the government says, we're not going to do this anymore. And then, of course, many organizations you represent come in and fill the space. All right, again, a refresher, I'm not gonna read every line on here, but since we have these three levels of government, federal, state, and local, you know, you're gonna see some redundancies in some of the services provided, and you're gonna see some unique aspects. And we're gonna visit this again a little further, but at the federal level, you know, primarily the feds are responsible for national defense, foreign policy, regulating commerce between the states, providing constitutional and civil rights in our whole federal court system. That's all the dollars and all the budgets and all the other programs and policies that go with this. I mean, other things, you know, you say, well, Greg, there's nothing on there about, you know, Veterans Affairs, there's nothing on there about the Department of Interior, there's nothing on there about the EPA or the FDA. So as we like to say in the classroom, broadly defined, these are the major categories the federal government is responsible for. So then what are these states for? These sovereign states, what are they doing? Commerce. So let me just mention, before I get to the states, I know that was really bad technique, but I want to make a point. At the federal level, and what so much of what Alexander Hamilton in the play focused on, some of the things Hamilton helped advance, was this idea about regulating commerce between states, because under the Articles of Confederation, as I mentioned, they were taxing each other. You know, if you were going to sell chickens in Pennsylvania and you wanted to sell them in New York could put a tariff on your chickens, protecting the chicken farmers in Pennsylvania. Or Vermont, you know, they wanted to sell ice cream and the people in New Hampshire said, oh yeah, fine. We're going to put an 80% tariff on it. So we needed to have something that leveled, you know, all the trade in the commerce between states. That's where the feds come in. And by the way, that is the back door to federal involvement in so many things across the United States, because if it involves interstate commerce, and I want to tell you, my good professor colleague here says, broadly defined is how the federal government looks at it. If it has anything to do with commerce, if you're moving any good or service across the state line, the feds get to have their fingers on it. So that's kind of the back door to how we have a lot of expansion, you know, that goes to things like the EPA and other things. All right. State government is responsible for commerce within the state, right? We know that. Anyone bought anything in Illinois to pay sales tax? If you bought liquor in Illinois, as liquor license, that's given by the state and the local government as well. So we have state commerce, we have courts, public safety and welfare, prisons, courts, jails, et cetera, at the state level, the state highway patrol, those kind of things, public safety, welfare, Department of Children and Family Services, and all the other social service agencies. Transportation, the state is responsible for elections. Gee, didn't we all just get a 2 or 3 month seminar on elections? But it's the states, and that's part of our model. And maybe, you know, all the fears about, you know, foreign hacking of the different technologies we use today. One of the things, you know, that I have taken a little bit of, given me a little bit of calm about it is you would have to be able to attack all 50 state systems, and the states delegate elections to the counties at the local government level. I mean, it's just so fragmented. You know, so you say, gee, it's a wonder it works, but you know, pretty much it works pretty well. Education, states, nothing in the federal constitution says a word about education, nothing, nowhere. Delegated to the states, I mean, sorry, retained by the states. So the states are responsible for public education. I already mentioned social services. Now, how does this spill down to the local level? Education again. So this is where, other than higher ed, so in Illinois and most states across the country, their involvement in education at the local level is by sending money and by providing guidance and rules and those kind of things, but they're not running local schools. That's, you know, at the county level or a school district level. So local government's responsible for education, the courts, you know, the county court, if you've had anything from a speeding ticket or you had a dispute with someone, you had a civil suit or a crime, if you know of a crime that took place and someone was prosecuted, that's gonna take place at a county court. Police, fire, emergency services, we're familiar with. Public health records, I mean, we don't know if you were born or if you died, or if you own a piece of property, all those records are kept at the county level. And again, these are little nuances, but I'll tell you, such what we consider a very ministerial job, you think of the order of society, things would be a lot different if there was no place to go where there was a repository of all that information and knowledge, because there's opportunities for fraud. There's opportunities just for knowledge. And of course, public health, we see in the last 10 months, we've been living through a public health crisis. And in fact, I got an email from I live in DuPage County. I got an email this morning from the DuPage County Health Department, et cetera. All right, land use and land use records are at the local level. Elections, we go to vote at a local precinct, et cetera, et cetera. Social services at the local level. And in Illinois, that's primarily townships do a lot of social service provision. Counties do a lot of social service provision. Some municipalities have ventured into that territory. And transportation at the local level too. One last thing I just wanna mention about land use and records. This is one of the unique aspects about the US form of government and these three layers and all this. Is how the built environment is organized, regulated, and executed is all the responsibility of local government. And what do I mean by that? If you own a piece of land, one, how do I know you own that piece of land? Goes back to records, right? And you have to be able to trace the title of ownership all the way back. But in order to build on that piece of land, most places, unless you're out, and even, you know, I grew up on a family farm, you can't build anything on that piece of property unless you get a permit, right? Because the government wants to make sure, primarily for safety, but also the use of the land. How dense can you put something? How tall can you make the building? How many people can live in that building? Is it a commercial building or is it a private dwelling? et cetera, et cetera. All the regulation of anything that goes on the land is done at the local level. And if you think about that, that's kind of an amazing thing. That goes back to this idea about local preferences, local control, et cetera. So we see things that are reflections of the model of government we have every day, but we just kind of look at them and drive by them and go, well, you know, oh yeah, there's our downtown. That makes sense. Oh, there's the industrial park. That's way over there. But if you live in any neighborhoods or come in closer, and it depends, you can find this even in DeKalb, you know, before zoning laws, and how is this executed primarily? Through zoning laws, the regulation of what can be put on the land, and then building permits of how whatever goes on the land is going to be constructed and fashioned. But I'll just say that, you know, earlier in the history of the United States, you might find some oddities. And I began my career in the village of Skokie, Illinois, which is what we'll call an inner ring suburb. And there's some places that the development that took place prior to the Depression, and you'd have a single family home, and then you'd have a three-story apartment building right next to it. And, you know, you don't find examples like that very much today, but if you go drive around some of the older communities, you're gonna find some oddities. You go, gee, that seems kind of odd there. Well, you know, techniques have changed and so forth, but that's a reflection of local decisions. Okay, so summary, fragmentation is a feature of our government. It defines the US system, divides and shares power. It increases accountability because remember, you can reach out, and as I say, you reach out and touch someone in one of these units of government. Or you can, what I said, and I actually had to give this lecture many years ago in China, is I said, well, because they asked, and I said, well, in the United States, if we don't feel you're doing the job that we want, we unelect people. That's a little different model than the group I was talking to at the time. It allows for local preferences. And so this idea about local control and more localized accountability are part of the heart and soul of our model. All right, so Alicia, I'm just gonna warn you, I'm gonna keep going because I've got more to share, but I'll pause. Anybody just on general, overall federal government, and I'm gonna take a swig of water.
So Greg, I didn't hear you mention specifically, but one of the things that surprised me when I moved to Illinois is the first time I heard about home rule. And I know that's probably a whole lot more time to explain, but in a shorter version, why do we have home rule and what is it? Why does it matter?
Okay, great question. And I actually took my home rule slide out in this next segment.
Of course, so and that's what I asked you.
Professor, yeah. No, in short, It's an absolutely important feature. And one of our professors, one of the early founders of our own public administration program, Professor Jim Banovitz, worked at the last Illinois Constitutional Convention, I believe was in 1970. Professor Banovitz and others helped write that legislation that created home rule. What home rule does, so I'll just try to tie it into some of those comments the last half hour or so. It further pushes down this idea of local control. So I have a slide that's going to come up here. All units of local government, and again, I'm just picking on Illinois, but these models generally apply across the U.S. All units of local government in the U.S. are creatures of the state. They are extensions of the state. They don't exist without the state's permission. And how does that work? You can go to, if you have nothing to do this weekend, go to chapter 65 in the Illinois Revised Statutes, and you will have so much reading, your whole weekend will be occupied. But literally chapter 65 and other chapters in the Illinois Statutes define how local governments must act, how and must they conduct their business. And what home rule does, it's a feature that allows the citizens of that community to decide for themselves, you know what, we're good. I trust these other, whatever, 50,000 or 20,000 people in my community. I trust the other 100,000 and we're good. We elect our own people. We can make decisions on our own. I don't need the state government to tell me how much I can tax for this and how much I can tax for that, or what I can do here, or what I can do there. So what it provides is a lot more local control without state intervention. So it carves out more authority, more quote sovereignty for that unit of local government. And there are home rule provisions, et cetera, in state statutes. But what it really did, it opened up a door to say, we can govern ourselves. You know, I don't need someone in Springfield who's represented by people from anywhere from Cairo, Illinois, to Galena, to Kankakee, you know, to Streeter, to Flanagan. I don't need them to tell me what to do. Again, us, me being us in our community, is we have our own elected officials, and just give us some guardrails and we're good. So that's kind of what it is in Illinois. How do you get a home rule? By population, automatically, if you're 25,000 or over, you automatically become a home rule community. The other way is by referendum. So any population in Illinois can become home rule by referendum. Oh, and the third choice, I feel like, let's make a deal. Door number one, door number two. Door number three is you can relinquish home rule by referendum. And there are communities that are here in the metro area and across the state that have, not many, and I don't have my home rule slides memorized because I haven't given that lesson in a while, but there's a few. We had a little bit of a rash of them took place, I think, in the 1980s. A couple of them I remember, I have to think, I believe Lyle would have been one of them. I don't want to say that if I don't remember for sure, but there are, the citizens can say, hey, you know what? Thank you, state of Illinois. You gave it to us, but we don't want it. And that's a whole nother lecture or two.
Thank you. I'll let you continue.
All right. So cities, state cities and local government, you have an idea now how this fits into the general picture. All right. Again, more trivia. If anyone remembers this by March, I'm going to buy you a drink. But if you're a student in our program, you're going to remember this. U.S. local government, the way we look at them has been characterized under something that's known as Dillon's Rule or Dillon's Law. And basically, if you're going to be an advocate for anything, or you're going to interact with your unit of local government, this is something to keep in mind. And it goes to what Alicia just asked me about. Well, why do we have home rule? How does it work? How does it fit in? Units of local government across the United States are creatures of the state, right? They are like children. They have been birthed by the state. They have zero authority to exist or operate other than the authority that's specified in those thousands of pages of the Illinois statutes or the Wisconsin statutes or the Iowa statutes. And they will tell you, I mean, if you start reading them, they're going to tell you how to do your tax levy. They're going to tell you what date it has to be done, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It's very prescriptive, but no unit of local government, no town, no township, it doesn't exist unless the state of Illinois gave it its impromptu and said, okay, you're good. You have a charter. You exist. And so some of you might have heard this phrase before, the corporate authorities. And we're not talking about the IBM corporate authorities or the McDonald's corporate authorities. We're talking about your municipal corporation, because that's what they are. They're actually corporations recognized by the state of Illinois. They're not private corporations. They're public, or what we call municipal corporations. Just as I mentioned here, the little footnote is Dillon's Rule. It's not a law. It's used, you know, in that kind of academic sense of a law. It was the result of a Iowa Supreme Court opinion that was written by John Dillon, who, by the way, was a corporate lawyer for the railroads. And just a little bit of trivia from Greg, and I think almost every political science professor that I know and city manager and others will tell you that next to the federal government, the entity in the United States that has the most power and authority are the railroads. And they wrote it that way a long time ago. So anybody who's ever dealt with the railroad trying to whatever, get a crossing fixed or something, to just say the best thing you can have is a whole lot of patience and some really good lawyers. So, all right. So Dillon's Rule, urban growth, we have changed. All right, the United States has changed. Look, at 1800, only 6% of the population lived in an urban area. 1800 to 1850, 15%. 1850 to 1900, 40%. 1900 to 1950, it was still 60-40. I mean, you know, that's kind of amazing. And current, you know, we're at 79% plus of the, and that number is going to continue to rise, right? And we see that more urbanization across the United States. So what does that mean though? It's how we live. It's where we live. It's the services and everything that goes with it. And, you know, I've been on two meetings already this week talking about the digital divide, right? About broadband and about how, what we learned through this pandemic. One thing is, yeah, you want to have remote classes, you want to have remote learning, but I mean, come on. I grew up where I went to grade at my elementary school, there were 750 people in that town. I mean, you know, if it wasn't for rural electrification at the farm I grew up on, as my grandfather and my dad said, they remember when it came. It was a big deal because why would the power company take and run miles and miles of copper to go to one farm? I mean, in where I live, and today, I mean, even when I grew up, there were more farms near us. They're now been abandoned, but you know, you just don't have the density to make a market work, so to speak. And that's part of what the digital divide problem is. If the private sector is gonna be the only determinant of where they're gonna put fiber, you know, it's less dense areas, right, have a hard time making a market case for themselves. So anyway, we're becoming more urbanized there. It's time for more visual relief. Look at that. What do you see? Can you see our urban areas? I know this is light pollution. It's what we're looking at. But I mean, look, many of us, right? We vacation in Michigan or go up to Wisconsin. My gosh, I mean, my wife grew up in Wisconsin, all her family's up there. We've gone way up there. And then when I look at this at night, I go, wow, there's still plenty of lights up there. I mean, you really have to get out into some areas that are very sparsely populated to not see the effects of urbanization. So I just think it's a representation. This is kind of what we look like, right? So the thing is, how do we govern ourselves? You have all these people living on top of each other. How do we govern? This is a little trivia map. How did we grow? There's a picture of the Northwest Territory on the left screen. But look at states and territories in 1790. We went as far as the Mississippi River, and then, you know, history tells the rest of the story. But it wasn't always this way, you know, and we continue to grow and change. So the idea about local government is that local governments are fundamentally extensions of the state. And the very first local governments created were the counties, all right? And we created about 2,000 counties from 1790 to 1900. And you might say, gee, that's kind of interesting, but why? It was really hard to go to, Kaskaskia, to do state business. I mean, we were all of a sudden 1818, we're the state of Illinois. It's like, okay, that's the seat of government, folks. Remember, the only way to get there at that time, walk, all right, take a horse. It's a long way. So states needed to have some kind of administrative offices somewhere else, right, spread around its population, its geographic area. And that's why counties were created. So they definitely, counties are the direct extensions of the state. We still have remnants of that today. Anyone ever in Illinois recognize the phrase, the state's attorney? The state's attorney's office is what? The prosecutor. Some states, they call them the district attorney because, you know, they're in a district, but they are actually employees of the state of Illinois. Yes, we elect them in each county and they have the title of state's attorney, et cetera. But that's just one example. We had to have jails. We had to have courts. Some of us in Illinois, you know the history of Abraham Lincoln being riding the circuit, right? He rode his horse from court to court to court. That's where that name came from. The circuit courts are because we needed to have places where people could come and do their business, their legal business, their records, their birth records, their property records. That's what the county did, right? By 1900, we had 2,000 counties. As of today, 3,031, and that number has stayed pretty much the same for a long time. There's the black and white version of the same map you saw earlier. Those are all counties in the United States. When people tell me local government doesn't matter, I just show them this picture. I say, okay, let's sit down and talk, right? All right, functions of counties, courts and judicial systems, law enforcement, the sheriff, vital records, roads and highways, social programs, taking care of the poor, public health. They also do some land use. So counties, and again, you know, without more time, there are a lot of nuances here as well, but generally this is what counties do. They were, quote, the first administrative offices of the state government. This is Illinois' view of our 102 counties over on the left in color. Pick out your favorite county or your home county. I grew up in county number 18, that's LaSalle County right there. And DeKalb County is right here, number 10. Oh no, nine, sorry. That was Kane. Nine is DeKalb. All right, cities and towns. So we've moved, as the statistics show, from the farm to the city. What do cities reflect? All right, why did people go to the cities? Why do we have urbanization? Why do we have, you know, Chicago grow up? And, you know, why did Philadelphia grow up? And, you know, just pick a place across the United States. Cities reflect access to resources, right? Jobs, economic activity, transportation, commerce, government. All right, that's what attracts people to any kind of a localized urban area. Again, cities are creatures of the state. Don't forget that. I know you'll forget it by March. I'm going to come back and visit all of you. Cities can only exist if they've been granted a charter by the state government, and the charters are reviewed and granted upon approval of the citizens in a specific geographic area. So not to give away too many secrets here, but Professor Shadiman might find this one interesting, because, you know, when you teach, we all come up with ways to try to connect and make learning interesting, right, Professor? So when I teach the local government class, I ask the students to go find the enabling charter for their municipality, because we have so many students that work in units of government. And can I tell you that only about 60% can come back and find it? I mean, I have had village clerks, city clerks, county clerks searching through mothballed boxes. And I said, how do you even know that you exist? And they've called the Secretary of State. Where is our charter for, I'm just gonna make it up, you know, I don't know, Lemonville, where's the charter? Nobody can find it. I tell the student, how do you know that you actually exist? So again, it seems perfunctory, but the citizens have to agree. And what's funny, the students that do find it, they find these votes, these referendums. It was 19 to 22. It was 16 to 31. I mean, there's just like a handful of people that decided to create a whole lot of the places that we recognize and enjoy today. Okay, Dillon's Rule, I'm not gonna hit on that again. This is just a little peek. This is the first phrase in chapter 65 of the Illinois Revised Statutes that talks about towns and villages. This is what a municipality means. So as I said, there's a lot of good reading this weekend for you to do. You can find this online, but I just wanna give you a flavor for how the narration would flow. Municipal or municipality means a city, village, or incorporated town in the state of Illinois, but and unless the context otherwise provides, municipal or municipality does not include a township town when used as the equivalent of a township incorporated town that has superseded a civil township, county, school district, park district, sanitary district, or any other similar governmental district. That's one sentence. I would mark that down in my class. Anyway, this is the way our laws are written. And so again, if some of you have done this in the past, you know, thank you. For those of you that haven't, you got a lot of good reading. All right, key elements of local government. We've already talked about these: police, fire, public works, infrastructure, land use regulations. Local government has significant impact on all of our lives every day. And in Illinois, these are some of the statistics. How does that 6,900 break up? 102 counties, 1,300 municipalities, 1,400 townships, 870 school districts, 397 park districts, 345 library districts, and 102 sewage districts. So we like local government, we just do. All right, now, if you're gonna interact with the local government, you're gonna find there are different models of local government. Oh, there's more. Like I said, I can go 16 weeks on this. But there's four basic forms of municipal government that you should be aware of when you start to interact with people, because this is going to tell you a little bit about the culture you're going to encounter, the processes you're going to encounter, the people you will encounter. First is a strong mayor form of government. All right, strong mayor would be, the mayor is the chief executive, and the chief executive would appoint all the department heads, they would supervise all the department heads, and they're going to have significant influence and power in their interactions with the legislative body, which would be a city council, and I can't say village board in Illinois because strong mayor does not go with village board in Illinois. Just, they just don't go together. It's a legal provision. So strong mayor, weak mayor. Weak mayor is the mayor is the chair of the legislative body, but is in many ways is more of a peer of the legislative body. They tend not to have any direct supervisory authority. They have other authorities. They do sign as the chief executive. They set the agenda typically for the meetings of the legislative body, et cetera. But strong mayors, for example, can veto any kind of local legislation. Weak mayors tend, if they have any kind of veto power, it's a modified version. And I'll tell you, in Illinois, because of home rule, we find some oddities. So you're gonna find some interesting things. Commission form of government was also, commission and council manager government were inventions during what was known as the Progressive Era, late 1800s, early 1900s. They were reform movements. You've probably all heard stories about the big city bosses in the 1800s across the United States, corruption, the Teapot Dome scandal and the Pendergrass family in Kansas City and political machines. Gee, in Illinois, anyone ever heard of a political machine in Cook County or in Chicago and the Daley family and all the predecessors? Well, in response, that was going on across the entire United States. That was known as Jacksonian democracy. It's a whole nother lecture. But we invented the two new forms of local government, commission form and council manager. Commission form is the one form of government that has the highest attrition rate in the United States. There are fewer and fewer and fewer commission forms. It was invented in the early 1900s. It was actually invented in Galveston, Texas, after the horrible hurricane that came through. And if anyone ever has a chance to go visit Galveston One, it's a beautiful place on the Gulf of Mexico, beautiful, beautiful island. The history about that hurricane is just phenomenal. Anyway, destroyed everything. And they had to try to recover and stand up their town again. And they created this form of government called commission form. And what happens is you elect all your department heads, a mayor and all the department heads. I'll save you the long lecture here, but let me just say it has its challenges in working well. I'll just leave it at that. Council manager government is the fastest growing government form of government in the United States. A strong mayor, a weak mayor, or commission could all change to council manager. And what does council manager mean in the broadest sense? It means that there's a city council and a mayor or a president. They do the legislative affairs of the government. They're still technically the corporate chief executive, but a city manager or a city administrator is responsible for running the day-to-day operations of the government, right? Making sure everybody's at work, the policies are executed, they do the planning and the organizing and the budgeting with the approval of the council and the mayor to execute the policies of the unit of government. Okay, we'll probably get into that some more. I have a chart here. I'll give these slides to Alicia so she can share them with you. But council manager continues to be on the rise. And as I said, commission is the one that's has the highest attrition rate. School districts are local governments too. So if you're interacting with local government, don't forget the school board. I'm sure some of you don't. Many of us are parents. If you send your kids to local school, you take a lot of interest in what's going on in your school district. But this is another feature of US, our fragmented form of government. A lot of discussions over the years with students in class about school boards and school policy and school books. You remember No Child Left Behind and all the other programs. We have a federal Department of Education, but it doesn't appear anywhere in the Constitution. There is no Department of Education. It's not even mentioned. It was delegated to the states. How the federal government gets its influence in education is through money. It's called fiscal federalism. That's a whole nother lecture another day. But you know, you get a lot of influence when you start sending big amounts of money to the states to do things, and education is one of them. Local districts, again, local officials, they're responsible to what? To build, staff, and deliver public education. The school they're in, the teachers that are hired, the superintendents that are hired, how big the school is, when you fix a roof or build a new school or take one or close one, all decided locally by local officials. The U.S. Constitution notice there. So here's just a little peek. Yes, schools are units of local government. Illinois Revised Code, Chapter 105. That's the school code in Illinois. And in 1855, it was the first time we had legislation authorized to levy a tax to support schools. And I'm proud to say my paternal grandmother was a school teacher, as are many, many of my cousins still are school teachers. And but my grandmother taught in the little one room school about a mile and a half from our farmhouse. And anyway, but if you think about it, we didn't start levying taxes in Illinois for schools until 1855. So anyway, over 2 million students in Illinois schools these days. Parks, park districts, here, just another view. You wanna read about parks this weekend, you wanna give up on the municipalities and schools, read all about parks, park districts. That's chapter 70 in the Illinois Revised Statutes. There you go. You click on one of these, all the reading you could, it'll take your Saturday and it'll give you such insight. But here, this is to Alicia's question. Why do we have all this? This is just, how do I say it? An affect of the states, you know, are actually regulating local governments. Yes, you can have a park district, but this is how you're gonna run it. This is how you're gonna do it, and et cetera, et cetera. But the most important thing is it allows you to elect officials to make the decisions to levy a tax and to budget and so forth. Okay, I know I'm getting over here, Alicia. I'll hurry up and probably skip things. But what I wanted to do is just mention about taxes. The property tax is the most loved tax in the United States of America. I mean, people have parties because when the property tax is due, people go out, they have parties, and they say, I love this because my schools, my municipality, my fire department, my community college, I when I write that check, all these services come to me. No, most people really, it's the most disliked tax in the United States. So anyway, property taxes are a fundamental way we finance local government, not the only way, but for special districts like schools, park districts, fire protection districts, it is almost their entire revenue stream. So when you start talking about property tax reform, municipalities, they have a little more latitude and depending on the municipality, but the property tax is the fundamental way we finance education in all our special districts, but certainly cities and villages take their share. That's a property tax bill. It's an example here in DeKalb. So if you haven't sat down and studied you, this is another homework assignment I give students. Go find a property tax bill, read it and interpret it. So, you know, all the good news is right there. Whoever you're sending money to and any debt they have, it's reflected in that. This slide, without going into detail, I'll just say that in most property tax bills in Illinois, you're going to find that in this case, this is an example in DeKalb County, about 60% of your property taxes are going to go to the primary and elementary schools because that's the only way they're financed. They get a few fees here and there. So this is pretty consistent. You're going to find it range anywhere from 55 to maybe even go up as high as 70% in some districts. I'm gonna scoot through this. Roles of elected officials. If you're gonna interact with the government, I would say you have to keep in mind what it is you're aiming to accomplish. The audience in some cases might be best to talk to the legislative branch, which would be the mayor, a village president, a park board member, et cetera. But remember, they're legislative. Okay, they are policymakers, and I guess the other title I was thinking about this morning, they're policymakers and they're also kind of ombudsmen, all right? If you feel aggrieved as a citizen, you know, many citizens will call staff directly. Remember, staff are appointed officials, they're employees, et cetera. They work for the elected officials. Those are their, technically, their highest level of supervision is the elected official, but there's always some kind of chief administrator, and, you know, whether it's a strong mayor in that model, but otherwise, there's typically an administrator of some kind, right? A park director, school superintendent, a city manager, a village manager, or something like that. So, you know, it depends on the kind of thing you're working on. Some cases, it may be better to start with the staff. And generally, you're going to start with a very senior level staff member, right? They're going to be more involved and understand policy concerns. If someone didn't come and plow your street today or something, they missed your garbage, you can call that department probably directly. Some people will call an elected official. Hey, you know, squeaky wheel gets the oil in some cases. But remember that all these units of local government basically follow this model. There's a group of elected officials. There's usually some kind of appointed officials or appointed board members, and that gets to be very idiosyncratic to whatever the unit of government it is. And then there's appointed employees and staff. Okay. Primary duties of mayors, chairs, or presidents. Some of you, this might seem something you would recognize right away. But they're responsible for providing that focused leadership and governance. They're the chief executive. They usually help set the organizational vision. They usually speak to the community. They serve as the corporate chief executive. They're usually the presider at meetings. They're the primary liaison to staff, typically. Again, this would be the mayor, the chair, the president, or whatever that title of the highest ranking elected official would be. And they tend to be the chief spokesperson. They also tend to be a consensus builder and negotiator on policy issues. They do a lot of community relations and ceremonial roles. And you know, why people elect them is because they bring a perspective that's different. You know, they're, in most cases, you know, they're elected at large. So they bring a whole community versus someone from a district or a ward or something like that. Legislators, they legislate. They're responsible for governance. They help set the vision. They do goal setting. It's the legislative body that sets policy goals. They undertake policy making, which means they go through a process of agendas, reviewing, approving new ordinances, new laws, new budgets, et cetera. Anytime they're going to spend money, it has to be approved by the legislative body. They're going to approve all the taxes and fees that are assessed. They're going to be that kind of ombudsman in the ear to gather public input. They're representatives, right? We have a representative model of government, so they represent residents. In some cases, it's at large. In Illinois, at the village level, most cases, they're all at large. If you're a city, or in some villages have introduced districts or boundaries. And the other thing is the legislative body would be the place where advisory boards would start to give their input and their opinion on things. All right, what else do they do? They're going to give feedback to staff. they are asked to stay informed. They're asked to analyze information. They're asked to assist with intergovernmental relations because the cities usually have to talk to the libraries, they have to talk to the parks, they have to talk to the schools, and they also participate in community events. All right, Professor, I have way too much information. I think I should stop, but I want to get to one slide before I bid adieu. So sorry for the animation here. I just want to, this is what I want to end with, about getting involved, all of you. And I know some of your discussion today is going to be about getting involved. This was a study that was done in 2001 by University of Illinois Springfield. And every time I use this data, I have not been able to find a subsequent study or an update of this study. And I'm always tempted to say, I think we should replicate it again. But the study was about why do people and how do people get engaged? And why are people not more involved? And I think this set of statistics is eye-opening. And it's just meant, I want to share it today to give you pause. Why do people not get involved? What do they identify? Family responsibilities, 59%, or job responsibilities. So almost 60% of people say, hey, I'd like to get involved. I just don't have time. Family, work. All right, but this is the next one is one that I think is a fundamental thing to keep in mind. A lot of people say, I'm not involved because no one asked me to be involved. No one asked, and they don't feel part of the community. And then, of course, the next ones kind of feed into that. They say they don't know enough about the issues. They don't know how to get involved. And then there's always that small portion of people that say, hey, I'm already involved and I'm involved in too much. But just end on this one. If you want to make a difference, et cetera, or if you think it's time for more voices, et cetera, invite people. Invite people for their input. Invite people to get involved. Think about your own personal, I can just reflect on my own, but I've shared this thought with many and had discussions with many in class and seminars about this. It's a whole different feeling when someone says, you know, I think you should consider being on this commission, or I think you should consider doing this. That just might be that one little piece of motivation or impetus to get someone to say, you know what, I'm going to give it some thought. And I know I've given seminars like this in the past, and I can tell you, I can easily count, probably fill both hands with the number of people said, you know, I remembered that session and I decided to get involved. They may have started as a volunteer, and what do you know, 6-8 years later, they're an elected official or something. So anyway, stay engaged, and I'll send these slides to Alicia, but I'm gonna yield the floor, and thanks for your time.
Thank you for presenting, Greg. I'll give you a hand clap. Everybody else joined me, I'm sure. So what I want to do now, Greg, I'm going to, if you can stop sharing your screen for a minute here. And then we're going to take a 5-minute break, and then we'll come back. In the meantime, if you do have questions for Greg, put them in the chat, and we'll see if we have time. We'll also adjust that at the end. So any questions for Greg, throw them in chat. But for right now, we will take a 5-minute break, and I'm going to put up a little timer. So let's see if I can do that. Just to keep us on track. Let's see. Maybe. All right. So I have my timer going. So we'll come back in 7 minutes. And by my clock, let's see, that is going to be 10:35. So we will see you back at 10:35, everybody. Thank you.
Just don't say love, say love, say love, say love no. I've heard that word misused 1,000 times before. And know that we don't have to dive in, cause we got all of the time in the world to say love, say love, say love, say love. Just don't say love, say love, say love, say love no. Misused 1,000 times before. Know that we don't have to dive in, cause we got all of the time in the world. Say love, say love, say love, say love. Say love, say love, say love, say love. Don't say love, say love, say love.
One of the polls is still up, the music poll.
Oh, okay. Let me go back and make sure that is off. Is it gone now? No. You can let me know if it's gone.
Yeah. Good.
All right. Cool. Again, if you have any questions for Greg, certainly put those in the chat, and I will forward them on to him. He's going to join us for a little while if he can, but I will also forward them on to him. So I'm going to talk a little bit about nonprofit advocacy broadly, and then we'll get to our panel discussion. And I like coming right after Greg because he really teed up a lot of how nonprofits, how they interact with government, how we can understand it. So one of the things that I talk about in my classes is how the nonprofit sector overlaps with the public sector and the private sector. I tend to think of us as, in many ways, we're similar to the public sector. And because of this public service motivation, we're very mission driven. And yet we're a lot like the private sector because we're regulated by government, the same as the private sector. We may be market driven. We may be, you know, selling goods and services either at a reduced cost or at market rate in some cases. And we govern in private, which is also different than the public sector. And that's something as you go between the public sector and the nonprofit sector or vice versa, is understanding what the rules and regulations are around that privateness versus the publicness. So for those of you, you're here because you're part of the nonprofit sector. So I won't go into a lot of details on the stats, just to kind of remind folks that most nonprofits in the United States, and we're at about 1.5, 1.6 million, depending on when it's captured, most of them are in that 501c3 category. 80%, over 80% are in that category. And that's important for several reasons, which is going to come up when we get into advocacy and lobbying, but also charitable tax receipts that you're allowed to give charitable donations to. So lots of tax exempt status benefits being a nonprofit organization or kind of in that subcategory of 501c3, the biggest one being exemption from federal income tax, eligibility to receive tax deductible charitable contributions specifically for those 501c3s. And then I put in italics, you may have exemption from state income sales and local property taxes. As Greg mentioned, it varies by state and it varies by a municipality or local government. In some states, it's automatic that you receive exemption from state income tax and sales tax. In others, it's not the case. And local property taxes, again, after Greg's discussion, this makes a whole lot of sense, is really at the local level. So Greg talked about the DeKalb County situation in the county here. You can receive property tax exemption, but not necessarily at 100%. And I came from the state of New Jersey before coming here, and it was either a yes or no. You either got property tax exemption being a nonprofit or you didn't. Here in DeKalb County, it's a variation from 100% to zero, depending on the case that you have. Churches, as a reminder, are not required to register as a tax exempt organization. They do automatically receive that 501c3 tax exemption, but some of them choose to register for lots of different reasons that they want to show transparency. They have more of a public focus to their organization, such as running a daycare or foster care, things like that. So what is advocacy, broadly conceived? The attempt to influence public policy, either directly or indirectly. And that may be working through a constituency or working directly with elected or appointed officials. So, and public policy, as Greg alluded to, and I always learn, not being born in this country and growing up with it, one of the biggest things that I've learned since moving to the United States was just how that federal system was created and how it really influences down to the local level on all cases. So that is certainly the case here in Illinois and in the state. So public policy then is what government chooses to do or not do. And sometimes not doing something is also a form of public policy. If government decides not to address a particular issue, that is creating a public policy in effect because you're saying that's not something we're going to address right now. And generally it's a formally approved policy goals and means to achieve them. So there's resources. And then the practices of those agencies that implement those programs. So in the state, and some of you work with state agencies, we might have state legislation, but it's actually the administrative branch, the bureaucratic branch that actually does the implementation and creates all the rules that then your organizations, nonprofits have to be subject to. So advocacy then can happen at the local, state, or federal level. And I think Greg did an awesome job kind of laying out where those are in the system, where they are, and how to influence those individuals. And this is kind of a round robin of advocacy tools. And I'll touch on each of them briefly. And then I think what I'll do is share most of this discussion will come become more apparent as we have our panel discussion. Then we want you to engage as well. How do you do advocacy? So I'll kind of just go a little bit around here. Coalitions is very common where you're getting together with like organizations or organizations that share your particular mission and you're acting as a coalition. And I'll give you some examples later that you'll see certainly human services, they've created certain coalitions. I would say that this often comes into play with trade associations, organizations that collectively represent you either in a regional, state, or federal perspective, or organizations that kind of share your missions. So these could be loose coalitions or formalized coalitions. And those coalitions are useful because they add greater weight to whatever you're trying to advocate for. You're trying to bring in a lot more people into those discussions. They can put greater pressure either on elected or administrative officials to do those things. And it tends to be or can be more organized. You have a plan, you have several strategies, so the implementation can actually be a little bit more formal. Media relations, a lot of you might be engaging in this already. issuing press releases about your particular work or about the research that's being done or about the issues that are addressing in your local community, and you want to get that word out. So you might be doing forms of media relations. Another one which we sometimes hear in the news is litigation. And I'll also give you some examples of organizations that when all else fails, they use the court system. So they will take, they will sue the state, they will sue an organization, they will sue, you know, an elected body to try to move that policy to the judicial level. And once it gets to the judicial level, depending on what the outcome is, then the hope is that that would force some legislative kind of response. Kind of on the second line then, looking at op-eds, and that is certainly something that organizations have done and are doing. If you read, and not necessarily just hard copy newspaper, which everybody doesn't necessarily read anymore, but even in the digital versions, you'll see the op-eds. If you look down in the bottom, you'll see who those are written by. Certainly right now that we've seen through the pandemic, a lot of hospital administrators, public health administrators, organizations that are serving individuals that are most affected by the pandemic, they're also writing op-eds to illustrate the issues that are going on, adding their voice to the, you know, growing concerns about how the pandemic is treating certain populations unevenly than others. And that's just one example, but you could imagine all these issues would really be right for an op-ed. And if you could also start at the local level, but all the way up to a more national kind of stage. That middle box, stakeholder education, I think a lot of you are already doing that, reaching out to your stakeholders to say, this is the issues that we see, here's the things that we're doing to address those things, here's how this particular policy is going to affect our community or the people that we serve. So I think stakeholder education is probably something that many of you are already doing. And then we come to lobbying. And lobbying is just one aspect of all the advocacy tools. And I think sometimes that's the scary one, I guess. And I'll talk more a bit about why that might be scary. But I think that's what people automatically go to when we say advocacy. That's the one thing that pops out. They're like, well, that's lobbying. And so lobbying is just one of the menu of advocacy tools that you have at your disposal. We're right now here at Northern Illinois. We are interviewing a state relations, we're hiring for a state relations person here at NNIU. And that person will be our voice and lobbyist, in Springfield, because we're a state institution. We want to make sure that our voice and our issues get expressed to the legislature in Springfield. So it is something that many organizations do. And it doesn't have to be scary, and it doesn't have to necessarily be restrictive. It's just something that you have among all of these tools available to you. If you look on that third row, then community organizing, and I think we do a good job at educating our students about how to do that. How do we get people to rally, to come together, to build support? You'll see, things like protests or online petitions or anything like that, where we're trying to really engage the community into action. That would come under that kind of bucket. Testimony. I don't know how many of you have ever done any kind of testimony before state or federal tribunals or committees, things like that. You might get asked to do those things because of your expertise, your background, or the organizations that you serve. And that's certainly another form of advocacy. Advertising, straight up advertising, whether that's in various media or social media, trying to get that word out about how these particular issues are affecting your various stakeholders, and you're putting dollars towards those advertising costs. Research is a big one for some organizations. For other organizations, that's not something that they engage with. Sometimes research comes under that coalition idea, where because of your association with a trade association or something like that, research might actually be done by another group. And then voter engagement is something that I've added in here, because I think when we've gone through this last election in particular, nonprofits were at the forefront of trying to get the vote out, particularly by people who might not have been, traditionally voting in the past or registered to vote in the past. And as we go through, we're just coming into a municipal election cycle in many communities. And I think voter engagement, again, will be another role that nonprofits can play, and another tool that they have kind of in this advocacy toolbox idea. So some research suggests that some most common types of advocacy are attending meetings, and that could maybe come along with testimonials, either at the local, state level, other committees. contributing public comment. So when the government has asked for public comment, an organization will actually say, well, this is what we're seeing, or, you know, this is the impact that we think these things will have. Forming an alliance with other groups. So those are that coalition building. And I think many of organizations, up to 70%, according to this research, they do that kind of alliance and coalition building. Providing expertise, same kind of thing, giving your background and some of your research and some of your experiences contributing to that advocacy. Providing media, so when a spokesperson from the media calls and asks you, you know, what have you seen? Are the numbers going up or down around this issue? Are we doing a better job or a worse job? Trying to get your feedback. About half asking members to call or send letters, email, et cetera, to government, whether that's legislative or administrative, about half of those are asking to do that. And another half are talking about the seeking the involvement of influential local figures. So I know a number of organizations who work closely with government, they will make sure that they are going to meet those local officials, you know, after an election, creating those partnerships and relationships with administrative officials to make sure that those groups know about them and that they understand kind of the priorities for those government officials as well. So some things around voter education, what you can't do is favoring one candidate over another, opposing a candidate in some manner, having the effect of favoring a candidate or group of candidates. So this does get a little tricky when you get into voter education. And so you wanna make sure that whatever candidates are running, that you're saying either you're presenting all of the candidates or you're sticking to the issues and you're not saying vote for this particular candidate. So if you're an organization and you have a particular issue that you're advocating for, you want to make sure that you're sticking to that issue. So we think this issue is very important without naming a particular party or a candidate, for example. And what you also can't do is take, you know, give contributions to political campaign funds or public statements of your position, whether that's verbal or written, made on behalf of the organization in a way that's going to favor or in opposition to any particular candidate for public office. And that's something that we've seen pop up and bubble up, and I'll get into that of why that's definitely more tricky. So some of you might have heard about the Johnson Amendment. This goes back to 1954 when Lyndon Johnson was actually not president. It was before, when he was a representative. And it's written into the IRS tax code. And the whole idea was to separate churches from politics and make that very clear of what they could and cannot do when it comes to politicking and really having picking sides, you know, advocating for one position or another. It bubbled up again because this was one of the issues that the Trump administration had promised to repeal and to make it possible that churches could, in fact, do a little bit more politicking and take sides and all of those kinds of things. So the Johnson Amendment is certainly in the background of the Trump administration. Nothing really happened. There are certainly pros and cons to the Johnson Amendment. So I'll touch on a couple of those. The people that want to keep it really say that, you know, churches that absolutely should be separate from government. And if we involve government, they have definitely much more of an exertion over control. So we want to make sure that that doesn't happen. And then people who said, well, if we extend it to churches, then why not all nonprofits? They should also be able to politic and do all those things. And then the big concern is any donations to politicians could run through churches or nonprofits and be tax deductible. So those are the folks who say, no, we should absolutely keep the Johnson Amendment. There are definitely some folks on the other side says, no, get rid of it. That religious exemption has forced the IRS to decide what's a religion. And if any of you watch John Oliver at all, he has a great, you can Google it and you'll find his whole series that he did on how you create a church in the United States and what allows you to get tax exemption is fascinating. But if we do throw it out, it does create some issues for that. Many churches also sit on extremely valuable tracts of land, for example. There were some cases in New York City about this that are currently not taxed. And so it definitely should be thrown out. So nonprofits can't endorse political candidates, but they already act quite partisan in many cases. And so how do you kind of judge that? There's definitely some gray. And you know, the rule has really never been enforced because you can imagine the IRS would have to put people in all the church pews in the United States to figure this out, to see how much they are actually politicking. And you know, if we got rid of them, maybe charitable giving would drop and the government would have to step in. So there's lots of kind of pros and cons about this, but I think most people agree that it's probably better to keep that separation intact. So this was in 2017, the Trump administration had signed an executive order to try to reduce some of that. It didn't really have any effect. And some people actually went to Washington and tried to protest that, but it really didn't affect anything. The Johnson Amendment is still alive and well. this comes from David Ahrens, and he's a researcher of nonprofit governance. He's down in, I want to say, Missouri. And he really comes out strongly that we really want to have that separation. But at the same time, we want to make sure that nonprofit organizations are participating in the public policy process, because we have, you know, close connections to the local communities. We can see the issues that are affecting our local communities. We know that providing direct service alone won't address the systemic issues that are underlying a lot of the causes and missions that many of you have. And so if we just continue to only serve, we could actually be contributing to the problem because we're actually not addressing it in a public policy way. So some of the boundaries around nonprofit lobbying specifically, because I think this is the one that kind of, you know, kind of freaks organizations out why they wouldn't want to do this. So you don't want to get into partisan politics. You cannot support or oppose any particular candidate. You can't direct endorsements or contributions by the organization to support or oppose a particular party. You can certainly communicate with the public and express a view about specific legislation, as well as a call to action for supporters. And I think we've definitely seen this in various issues over the years where nonprofits have put out that call. We oppose X, Y, and Z policy or the bill that's being considered. Please reach out to your local officials. Please contact your state representative, those kinds of things, which are all allowed under the current lobbying rules. So federal laws do allow every nonprofit to engage in some legislative lobbying. And I know this makes nonprofits nervous about lobbying, but you can do some lobbying within rules. So there are spending limits and technicalities that kind of around those spending limits. So nonprofit, the Congress actually put in the IRS in 1934 that no substantial part of the activities may be for carrying on propaganda or otherwise attempting to influence legislation. So it's that substantial part, which is the tricky part. And there is really no test for what does substantial mean. And if they wanted to, if anybody wanted to fight how much you're spending on lobbying, what would be that measure of substantial? And that's where nonprofits get a little bit nervous. So you are allowed to freely engage in some lobbying as long as that activity, again, falls under that insubstantial part. But Congress or the IRS has never really defined kind of what that means. So you're left with a couple of choices. And one of your choices, see if I can go back. So one of the choices is to choose to be under what's called an expenditure test instead of the substantial test. And that simply allows the nonprofit to opt out of that substantial activity test and use this expenditure test, which is sometimes cleaner. And it's a 501H election form. So this expenditure test means if you have expenditures under 500,000, you're not allowed to spend more than 20% of your tax exempt purpose expenditures on lobbying. So that's kind of an easy one versus the substantial test. If you want to engage in significant lobbying, this gives you a little bit more guidance rather than the vague kind of substantial test that has existed. So there are definitely some cautions. If you engage in excessive lobbying activity, so beyond that, the thresholds, you can lose your tax exempt status, which is then your income is subject to tax. And if you exceed those lobbying expenditures in a particular year, you could often face an excise tax equal to 25%. And private foundations, churches, auxiliaries, they're not allowed to file those 501H election forms. So these are only for your more traditional 501c3 nonprofits. The other thing that makes it a little bit different is nonprofits that receive any federal funds at all, and then use those funds to attempt to influence federal or state legislation through direct or grassroots lobbying, those are not allowed. So if you get federal funding, there's also another layer here that you just have to be aware of if you're thinking about engaging in those lobbying activities. We know from some research that the larger the nonprofit, the more likely they are to engage in advocacy at all levels of government, as well as organizational age has a positive effect. So both of those seem to contribute. So smaller nonprofits are less likely to do advocacy, especially moving into more of that lobbying idea. And mainly this is probably more of a resource issue than anything, because you don't necessarily have any dedicated staff to do this. So you're operating pretty lean. And the other thing I think is the, you know, possibility of certain stakeholders might not be in favor of you doing that work, whether that's the board, your members, your donors, those kinds of things. So you may, you know, want to stay more nonpartisan just because you don't want to alienate any particular donor or any particular constituency group. During the Illinois state budget crisis, which I'm sure all of us remember, 2015 to 2017, this is when we had no state budget for almost 800 days. And if you were in a state contract with your social service agency and you were with a contract with the state of Illinois, those were not being paid except under court order. And at one point we had $15 billion in unpaid bills during that. So, and that didn't just affect health and human service agencies. Organizations like the Illinois State Arts Council went to zero funding for those 2 years, which means any of the arts organizations in Illinois who relied on funding from the Illinois Arts Council, they got zero during those 2 years as well. And kind of what happened during that, what happened during that state budget crisis is it woke us up a lot to say, what do we do in when we're facing these issues? We really need to know what's going on at the state level, because we're so intricately tied due to funding from the state issue, from the state budget. But that really highlighted that relationship, especially if you have that financial relationship in your health and human service organization. So the board, this is not just a staff responsibility, it is the board, and I'm sure we're going to talk about that as we get into our panel discussion, but the board is really, this is an author who talked about the most useful but underutilized asset when it comes to doing this work of advocacy. They tend to be the ones who are the most supportive of your mission, and they already have volunteered their time and are often donors. They're putting up their personal reputations into the organization. So they really are your best advocate. And what I noticed during the state budget crisis was that some organizations were using staff to do advocacy work. And some organizations were actually using volunteers, clients, and board members. And I think that's really interesting, because when you have staff members out there doing advocacy who are being paid by the nonprofit, it didn't, in my mind, in my opinion, it didn't play as well, because they're taking a paycheck from that organization. So it looked like, you know, we have to make sure that funding is released because I rely on this. I have a personal stake in this. It was much stronger when a board member, a volunteer, a client, a user of those services was advocating for those services rather than a staff member. So that was something that kind of bubbled up to me when I was watching during the state budget crisis, how other organizations were kind of responding. So some organizations do client advocacy. So Illinois Action for Children, and some of you may be part of this organization or not, they're what I would call one of those coalitions, organizations that serve children in the state of Illinois. They come together and advocate on behalf of children in Illinois, on behalf of families, so that if you're a smaller organization, you might join this organization, and that would do some of that research, education, outreach, engagement, those kinds of things. Another organization, Chicago Coalition for the Homeless. So right in their mission, they organize and advocate to prevent and end homelessness. That's part of it. And some nonprofits, they don't put that word advocate in there, and some do. So you know that this is definitely one of their missions, is to address those systemic issues, not just service delivery. You also have nonprofits who are doing issue advocacy, and here, you know, this law just came out. It was actually just announced on the 19th. It went up to a federal judge that permanently banned Illinois' panhandling law from being enforced on the basis the statute violates the First Amendment. And this was a case that was brought to litigation by the ACLU and the Chicago Coalition for the Homeless to eliminate laws at the municipal level for panhandling. And it was interesting, if you go back and you can read the decision, but they actually reference things like, but other nonprofits, for example, they can be on the street fundraising. So if you think of Salvation Army, but Girl Scouts. I mean, you can name a number of organizations that are in public spaces or even in private spaces that are fundraising. They actually mentioned that in this particular law, like, what's the difference? If they can do those things and that's protected, you know, why can't we then panhandle as well? So we'll see how this results in, and there's some municipalities now that they do have on the books panhandling laws against it. So how they're going to react to this federal judgment will be interesting in the next coming weeks, because this just happened on the 19th. An organization that we're actually working with here in the center is FLAP, which stands for the Farm Worker and Landscaper Advocacy Project. Again, advocacy is right in their name. Their goal is to improve working conditions for low-income workers. And what we've seen in during the pandemic is these are the folks that are the essential workers, right? The people that are working in the canneries and the farms, greenhouses, landscaping, all of those folks, restaurants. The ones that are most effective. And they use a number of different advocacy approaches, including litigation. They've gone to litigation in many cases. They have lawyers on staff to do that, but then they also use all of those other tools as well. Sector advocacy, and I'll wrap up with this. So the nonprofit sector is very splintered in that we have this 1.6, 1.7 million nonprofits across the country. But we're all in various silos, whether that's arts and culture, human services, environment, and we build coalitions within our missions. So arts groups join arts associations and human services join human services associations. But who's advocating for the sector as a whole? We're smaller than the public and private sectors. We represent about 10% of the workforce in the country, but significant. So 1 out of 10 people work in a nonprofit that you and I know. That's significant. So who's advocating kind of for the sector? And we do this in a number of different ways. So Board Source is one of those organizations. They've been working with a number of other national associations to try to get the sector to come together, especially to empower boards to speak directly and to do advocacy work on behalf of those organizations. Another organization that's important for us here in Illinois is our state nonprofit association, which is Forefront. And, you know, interestingly, not every state has a nonprofit state association. Many of them have fallen away, whether that's through just revenues or other governance issues. But we're fortunate that we do have a state nonprofit association here, and they do public policy and advocacy work on behalf of their members. They have a legislative and regulatory position papers and resources that really help the sector pursue those kind of policy initiatives. So if you haven't checked out Forefront or you're not a member right now, they have a lot of free resources, but if you become a member, you get access to a number of different kind of libraries and events, things like that. One of the best organizations I would say right now that's been very active on a national level is the National Council of Nonprofits. And what I love about the National Council of Nonprofits is that they send a weekly e-newsletter saying what all the legislation that's going on across the country, what's coming down or proposed that could affect nonprofits. So when the PPP loans rolled out, you know, nonprofits really weren't mentioned in it, but now nonprofits are getting access to it. The second round is coming. What does that mean for nonprofits? So they really dissect what's happening at the federal, state, and local level, affecting all nonprofits across the country. So you can get that as a free e-newsletter once a week. You can also go here to their everyday advocacy resources to get a lot of toolkits and information that will help you when you're thinking about how do I want to start this advocacy work? Do I want to start this advocacy work at those various levels? So this is an example of their public policy planning checklist. How do you convene people together to talk about this? Who should be at the table? How do we train board and staff to do this work? So all these resources are freely accessible from the National Council of Nonprofits. Some books that we are we have here and we've used in classes and that we're considering going forward is Seen But Not Heard. This is by the Aspen Institute. They're out in Colorado. At Nonprofits and Policy Advocacy, and a new one that came out last summer, The Quest for Attention, Nonprofit Advocacy in a Social Media Age. So if you're using social media to do advocacy work, this is a book you might want to check out. Like I said, it just came out last summer, so I just requested a copy to take a look at it, because we are going to be teaching a summer undergraduate class in nonprofit advocacy. And Linnea Erickson-Laskowski of Safe Passage here in DeKalb is going to teach that for us. It's going to be online Wednesdays from 6 to 8 p.m. over the summer. So we're trying to look at all of these textbooks and see what resources are out there for undergraduate students, because most of us don't take these classes as an undergraduate. Some of this you could take if you did a master's degree in something like nonprofit management or public administration. We have some of those classes here in the MPA program, but this is the first time we're going to offer this kind of at the undergraduate level. Okay, so I am going to stop sharing my screen here in a second, and I want to introduce our three panelists for the rest of this morning, and we're going to have a really good discussion, I know, and then we hope to get some participation from all of you. So first we have Sandra Harrison. She's the co-founder and chief training officer for Leaders in Transformational Education, acronym LITE, in Aurora, and she'll give more of her background. This is the quick version. Jill Olson, executive director of CASA DeKalb County, and David Roth, executive director of the DuPage Federation on Human Services Reform. So let me go ahead and stop sharing. There we go. Get away from my screen for a second. And what I've asked each of the panelists to do is to give us a little bit more description of their organizations. And then we're gonna kind of go round robin about how they define advocacy and how do they do advocacy in each of those organizations. So Dave, do you want to just kick us off? Give us your name, background, a little bit about your organization.
Sure. And Alicia, would it be all right if I popped a screen up now?
Yeah.
I'm not sure exactly how this is going to go, but if I can share a screen, this might cover a lot of ground that I won't have to say out loud. Let's see if I can get a screen to show up here.
If you can, I know you sent it to me, so I can try to pop it in too, but that looks good to me.
All right. So if folks are able to see that screen, let's see if I can get that to advance a little bit. All right. Is that visible now?
Yep, it looks perfect.
Very good. So introducing us, I want to talk about the first couple of slides. I'm Dave Roth, and I'm executive director of DuPage Federation on Human Services Reform. We were formed about 25 years ago when state government and local government were trying to figure out a better way to do human services. State government had reorganized the way that it did human services and was looking to have an influence at the local level. Our council was put together to be a collaborative body working through that. Our founding director, Candace King, retired 2 years ago after an astounding body of work at DuPage Federation. And now I've been on board for 2 years, and half of that, of course, has been around pandemic response. So we're not a direct service organization. Our constituent parts are providers of human services, both public and private. Also the entities that influence policy that affects human services, and also institutions that rely on human services like hospitals, healthcare, courts. And we have some special strengths that have built up over time. Our work to build an effective human service system has led us to looking at where there are gaps and building collaborations to meet the gaps. And in our history, that means language access. So we've built up an interpreter training program. We'll place interpreters, but the really big deal is we want all human services to have the capacity inside themselves to deal with all of the languages and cultures that they encounter in the community. That's how we get to effective services. The second area for us is public benefits eligibility. Those benefits, be that unemployment, SNAP, Medicaid, for folks of very low income, that may be the thing that allows them to heal, get back to work, care for their kids. So we work to make sure that our constituents know how to get their clients engaged in appropriate public benefits. Special focus here on non-citizens. What can be done there? Because there's a ton of fear in the world today about entering into the world of public benefits if you're an immigrant. There's a fear that you will be hurt by that. So we need to kind of inform folks so they can make an educated decision. So I'm not sure how far, Alicia, you want me to go through how we do advocacy or step back?
Yeah, do you want to hold that till the next part? If you want to stop sharing, we'll have Jill and Sandra go, and then we'll come back.
Thanks.
Yep. Go ahead, Jill.
Hey, hi, I'm Jill Olson. I'm the executive director of CASA DeKalb County. CASA stands for Court Appointed Special Advocate. So we hear that word, advocate, part of advocacy. We represent and advocate for abused, neglected children in the court system. And since we are located here in DeKalb County, we do it for DeKalb County children. The CASA program is a program that exists nationally here in the United States. There are CASA programs in all 50 states. Just very briefly, historically, it started back in Seattle, Washington in the mid 70s when a juvenile court judge was hearing cases involving children who had been abused or neglected and were in the court system through no fault of their own, looked around the room, saw all these experts and lawyers and said, I don't need one more expert. I don't need one more lawyer. What I need is someone who is going to really go out there and be my eyes and ears and go out and gather the information that, about these children, how they're doing, where they're living, you know, what kind of services they need and so forth, and bring that back to the court. And so he essentially created what was a grassroots type volunteer-based organization. And we all function in that way today. So we are a volunteer-based organization who does advocacy work for children in the court system. Here in DeKalb County, we've been here since 1993. So doing the math, we've been here quite a while. And we continue to represent abused, neglected children in the court system. So we do a lot of advocacy. Clearly, that's the core mission of our organization. And then just looking at it from a structural standpoint, most CASA programs, particularly here in Illinois, we operate as independent 501c organizations. So even though we work within the court system, which normally you would think of as a taxpayer-funded extension of the court system, we are not. We are an independent nonprofit organization. So we also do advocacy that impacts the organization as a whole, either locally here or as part of the other CASA programs here in the state of Illinois, and to some extent also nationally.
Thank you, Jill. Sandra.
Here. Hi, my name is Sandra Harrison, and I am the founder, co-founder, and Service Chief Training Officer for LIGHT. LIGHT stands for Leaders in Transformational Education, and the center of our work is entrenched in supporting opportunity youth. And opportunity youth are those young folks who are 16 to 24 years old who are disconnected from school and or work. And so I'm really excited to be here to talk about the many ways that we advocate for those young people doing that work, simply because they have so many complex issues, from complex trauma to workforce development and needs and parent training even for some of them. We partner and offer a wraparound approach to addressing some of those issues for those young people. So thank you for allowing me to be here.
Thanks, Sandra. And why don't we go in reverse order then, and you can dive into a little bit more of how does your organization do advocacy, or how do you even define it? Because as we've said, it's a big tent of lots of different things.
It is a big tent. And, you know, at the beginning, and I think at the core of our work is collaboration. And it has to be collaboration because collective impact is the one thing that, you know, we want to see to help kind of move the system along. And we realize that because these young people have so many needs that we can't do all of this work. We talked about a social sector early on and just having sort of those mental health components and having other components to be able to advocate for young people at an educational level or at a government level. So we do this in multiple ways. We create community opportunities for all of our nonprofits to participate and build capacity for those nonprofit organizations. And so as we're doing that, we're constantly advocating both for the youth and for their families to grow. We also do this by sitting on community commissions, education commissions, and workforce commissions to make sure that our voice is being able to be heard as we hear from our young people and hear from our parents and move that advocacy work up the chain to create that impact.
Thank you. So Jill, do you want to comment a little bit further about what is an advocacy as part of your core, for sure, that you advocate for the children? So that might be a little bit more well understood, but are there other areas that you want to elaborate on and how you do advocacy work at CASA?
Yes, in addition to the core of our mission, which, as you said, is the advocacy work for children in the court system, We certainly advocate for a number of things that are directly or indirectly related to child abuse and neglect. So, you know, as part of a CASA network here in the state of Illinois, we certainly always want to advocate for those issues that most directly affect these children. These are oftentimes children who are removed from their homes because of the abuse and neglect. So that brings in DCFS, the Department of Children and Family Services. And so there is a connection that way, even though we operate very independently. And so sometimes it's important to advocate for the issues that are significant to these abused and neglected children, because our focus is very different from DCFS. DCFS is there to provide services to the family as a whole, so that particularly as it relates to children who've been removed from the home, those problems or issues can be fixed, if you will, and then the children can be returned home safely. We look at it strictly from the standpoint of the children, because we are their voice as part of this proceeding. So we always want to advocate, whether it be, you know, locally, whether it be at a state level, and certainly, you know, somewhat to the national level, that people understand that these are children who, through no fault of their own, are part of the court system because they've been abused or neglected. And that child abuse and neglect happens everywhere. I mean, people are shocked to think, if we're looking at DeKalb County, you know, as a whole, people are oftentimes shocked to think that this goes on in DeKalb County. You know, you look around, you think we live in a nice, you know, community, but it does exist everywhere. So that advocacy, you know, like I say, is done both at a local level to make sure that not only the issues of child and abuse and neglect are on people's radar, if you will, but they are aware that there are programs like CASA that are there to advocate for these children. And so that's part of the whole process.
And so, Dave, you can dive in a little bit more about how your organization views advocacy and how you do that on the issues that the Federation cares about.
All right, good. Well, I so enjoyed listening to Jill and Sandra. I think I might tell two stories first and then go back to the slide very briefly to kind of sum it up. Our definition of advocacy, Alicia, is just what you presented. It's about influencing public policy that our constituents know is good for the community and bringing optimal well-being. So here's a story. Last spring, as soon as the pandemic hit and the stay-at-home order was instituted, we got a call from the constituent services leader in Representative Sean Casten's office. He's a United States representative, and we've had some work with them in the past. And he said, "So what's going on with human services?" And things were changing so quickly, I didn't really have a good recap for him, and I invited him to join us for a meeting. Let's get some leaders together and do a roundtable listening experience. And so we did put that together, and we ended up also involving the offices of Representative Bill Foster, Representative Lauren Underwood, and one of the things that we talked about was financial impact. So those were the days when the Congress was trying to figure out what to do about PPP and who should be involved. So we had about two dozen organizations that had a direct opportunity to express in a 90-minute session, what was the impact on them financially? Why would financial relief be a help to them? That wasn't the only thing that we looked at, but it was a key. And so I'll never forget Representative Casten's office brought their DC legislative liaison in we did a series of meetings. It brought her into one early on, and she said, "This is fantastic. I get a chance to hear the whole breadth of what's going on in one kind of compact hour." So that would be an example of a way in which we influence that kind of policy. That's not a human service policy, but it's making sure that human services are incorporated inside this very important tent.
Yep.
So you know what, maybe I'll stop there for a moment. I'm gonna reshare and kind of put this into a very quick context. So when I say that we work to influence policy, there are really four kinds of things we do there. And if you're looking at number five here, A is investing in those relationships, Representative Casten and Underwood and Foster. Number two is gathering intelligence from data and constituents. And in the story I told you, that data was people expressing what's going on in their organizations. At other times, we might be preparing fact sheets and doing a little bit of data research on who's affected in what way. And the third part for us is developing solutions. That's almost all of our advocacy work really depends on having something viable to put forward that will work for human services and that will be feasible in the political sphere. The fourth thing going there to 5D is developing kind of entrepreneurial skills for policy. I came to DuPage Federation after 30 years of doing advocacy work. The world has changed so much. I had to forget everything that I thought I knew would work. And we have to look for avenues where there's opportunity. And where do we have a strength? Where do we hear a need? Where do we have a relationship? How can we leverage that into something meaningful? So that's kind of an entrepreneurial role.
Yep. Thank you. I'll go back to Jill maybe, because you mentioned, Jill, that you work with your state association and somewhat nationally. Can you tell us a little bit more how those collaboration advocacy efforts help you here locally, but why you lean on the, maybe your regional, state, or national CASA to help you do that advocacy work?
Yes, it's strength in numbers. Most of us who are local programs are, by nonprofit standards, relatively small programs. By that I mean, you may have a staff of anywhere from 2 to 5, something like that. When you have small staffs, you can only do so much. So there's strength and safety, if you will, in numbers. And so that's why we, even though we operate individually, we collaborate, across county lines and regions of the state to do that. And we do have a state, an Illinois CASA program, which is our state organization. They don't have any control over us directly, individually as local programs, but they were there and have continued to kind of help garner all of us together and the issues that are important to us. And, then we can make our cases if need be down in Springfield. So one of the big initiatives was a funding initiative. CASA programs had not been funded by any taxpayer funds to speak of since their inception here in Illinois, which was the first program in the mid to late 80s. So Illinois CASA took it upon itself to, they hired a lobbyist to work with them. And then they garnered all of us as local programs to be part of that process. So there were people from local programs going down and testifying in front of the various members of the House and Senate. There was the behind the scenes stuff, there was the letters, the emails, and that kind of thing. So we could not have done that as an individual program. So for us, that was really a significant way and ultimately a successful way for us to be able to get some funding through the state to support these programs, which was so crucial. But I mean, again, it doesn't have to necessarily happen just on the state level. It can happen on the county level. And again, it doesn't have to necessarily always be directed to funding, but for nonprofits, that's a big issue, And so, you can do the same thing by working with your local county board. So here in DeKalb County, we get some funding from the county board. And I always make a point to make sure that I go in at least a couple times a year. Now I'm doing it virtually, but before I would do it in person, and just kind of give a presentation, kind of telling them what's going on, so they have a better sense of what we're doing. I think it's also important to make those connections through things like your local chambers of commerce. The Chamber of Commerce can function, there's a nonprofit division of that. They can likewise function in a capacity where they're going to be able to be your strength. If you can connect with them, there may be certain issues that'll come up where the strength with them and other nonprofits that are members, as well as even the for-profit community, can help you move whatever issue you are advocating along. So I think it's always important to look first, what do I have locally that I can connect up with as a nonprofit, whether it's another consortium group of similar like nonprofits, whether it's the local chambers, whether it's your county board, look to see who those are locally. And then there's some things, as we said, that have to be addressed either statewide or nationally.
So Sandra, how do you connect with your regional or state national associations?
I'm sorry.
How does your organization connect with local, state, or national organizations to do some of this advocacy efforts, or do you?
Oh, we do, by promoting education and training, and by creating the data and following that up with a story, because if we can create a story that kind of tells the data points, then, you know, it's a little bit easier to do in advocating. Yeah, for sure. Yep.
And Dave, yourself, you're kind of the collaborator. You're the convener in many cases, not a direct service provider. So you're on the other side of this coalition building, but your organization itself, what other coalitions are you a part of at the state or national level that help you do advocacy?
So, well, we're opportunistic, depending on what's the level of leadership and need. And what Jill and Sandra have mentioned is so important to our success. Their work inside their issue areas and their work in broader community building, all of that strengthens our ability that when it comes time to put together a little bigger umbrella, Jill and Sandra are trusted leaders in their world and in their community. If they view an issue and say, I understand how this affects me and I understand how this can affect my group, then we have the opportunity really for broader influence. So for us, we have some key regional, state, and national associations that are relevant because of the kind of history we've built up around language access and public benefits particularly. And these days, we're bringing greater and greater energy to focusing on racial equity. So it's a day for finding new partnerships and building new relationships, first inside our community and then building out. So for us, in Illinois, there's a coalition called Protect Our Care Illinois that is so important around making sure that healthcare is available to everyone. No one is disadvantaged because of income or race or geographic location. Very important to us. And that statewide coalition has its own national reach. So when President Biden announced that the marketplace is going to reopen for the Affordable Care Act, we can be sure that our state association, working with a national association, has been working diligently with President Biden's leadership to make sure that this was on the agenda. That's a crucial COVID-19 recovery strategy. Oh my goodness, that's going to bring benefit to so many folks. So there are, I could name the Protect Immigrant Families Illinois. That's another big one for us. Illinois Partners for Human Services, huge for us. We really appreciate that. And as we're moving more deeply into racial equity space, we found great partnerships with some of the folks that we worked with on census promotion. The Illinois Muslim Civic Coalition, the DuPage NAACP, that's just the start of what is, I think, an exciting time for our community and region to advance racial equity.
You know, and if I can jump in, Alicia, I just want to kind of piggyback on what you're saying there about racial equity. And to that end, we partner with a local organization called ICOI. And because some of our work with Opportunity Youth also leads us into working with such complex trauma in some of these young people, just the ability to be able to build that understanding in the organizations and our community around how to work with trauma, how to work with young people who have experienced those complex traumas, but also educating the staffs for the nonprofit organizations in the community to ensure that they are trauma-informed and understand those complex needs of that population.
No, I think, and that work has probably just begun and is definitely ongoing.
It has just begun for sure, because when you talk about digging into those diverse and equity and inclusive types of trainings and education for our community, and we're talking about all of the things that COVID has kind of dumped on as a result to Black and brown communities, that work gets bigger and bigger because you start to see that trauma, not only on the young people that we are working with in their families, but also as those essential workers we mentioned earlier, some of the trauma that they're experiencing being on the front line, making every last one of those young people an encounter for each of us as we go among our daily COVID lives.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And have any of you had experiences where I mean, I think it's tough to do some advocacy when you're funded by the same organization that you want to advocate against some of their policies. Have any of you run into that where you're like, yes, I'm grateful for this funding, but I really need you to do this or address this kind of issue? It gets tricky, but I don't know if any of you have experiences with that. Jill, did you think of something?
To a limited extent, but I think it goes back to a word that just was used previously, and something you mentioned also is the whole concept of advocacy by educating. I think you can be very diplomatic and educate, even though you may be taking a different approach and maybe being contrary to what, you know, whoever you're in front of. But I think that's a really important part is educating them, because sometimes they haven't thought about it that way. And so, you know, while on the face of it, Matt, look that you are on two opposite sides of an issue, after you've had the opportunity to educate as part of your advocacy work, then it tends to draw those sides closer. So I think education is really an important part of advocacy. You need to know your stuff so that you're in a position to advocate. You need to know who has like-minded principles and maybe bring them in, because it goes back to that strength in numbers. And then, you know, if it is somebody, you know, let's say it's a funder. I mean, you know, funding is crucial for all of us, and you don't want to tick off your funders. But on the other hand, I truly believe that, you know, if you give them the opportunity to be educated on something, they will be more inclined to look at it from your perspective and may take a different position on it. And in the end, that's what advocacy is all about.
Dave or Sandra, do you have a thought there, or an example of where you've been challenged by the advocacy work you're trying to do because there's a funding involvement?
Well,
Go, Dave.
You know, I could add a little different angle to it. First of all, what Jill said is, oh my goodness, that's the big umbrella. Mm-hmm. And I find that with state funding these days, that state program managers and grant managers are hungry for information. Mm-hmm. Despite Greg did this fantastic presentation about the complexity of government, and I want to say that at the same time that complexity is there, we have in many ways diminished state government's ability to manage relationships with nonprofits because we've kind of hollowed it out. There are fewer people working there, and they're more kind of calcified in their own silos. And so education with those folks is really important because it kind of frees them to do the right thing. The big challenge from my perspective is when, and we don't have this problem, but in my career, I've had this problem. When the funding relationship is not well managed, you don't get space to talk about policy and advocacy. It's not an issue of fearing what it is that you want to talk about. It's about that your survival depends on getting them to change something, to do it the way they said they would do it, or to do it right, or whatever that is. And all energy is kind of sucked into that battle.
Yeah. Sandra, your thoughts?
Oh, wow. Wow. Ditto. when you get sucked into that battle, I mean, you know, education and training, and that's kind of where Light is centered in its work. But you know, we spoke earlier about funding, and we spoke earlier about being able to pull those testimonies to the forefront, and it becomes very hard to get those testimonies, tell those stories, to be able to advocate for people using their very own words when you're kind of locked to just do this kind of systematic work that is outlined in your work plan or your document that doesn't even allow for that kind of open communication to get someone's story to the forefront so that you can advocate for them in a different way.
Yeah. I think one of the challenges, especially for smaller ones, and Jill, you mentioned it too, is staff, having staff to do this. This falls under that communications outreach, all the stuff that's not program that is very challenging to fund. And I don't know how each of you have kind of addressed that. How do you assign these kinds of tasks to staff when they're almost exclusively funded to program? Is it left to you guys as leaders or interns, or how do you manage that side?
Yeah, it's a combination of all those things, because you hit it on the head. funders traditionally, especially if they are government funders in the form of grants, do not want to fund something that they feel is not directly related or direct services oriented. Mm-hmm. And they fail to stop and think, and this is where the education comes into it, they stop to think that you can't provide your direct services if you can't do all these other things. And part of that is the whole education and advocacy and that kind of thing that they would look as outside of your direct services. So it is a challenge. So you kind of have to figure out, how am I going to fund, you know, having staff time towards these things that we really need to do to continue to strengthen the viability of the organization, because it's so important. I mean, not only for your individual organization, but just in general, because how am I going to fund it? And that goes back to that education part. And that is something that I have attempted to do with some of our local funders, is to try and remind them that when they set up their, you know, their grant applications or their, you know, foundation applications, and they are so project oriented or direct service oriented that they're overlooking the fact that we have to have that organizational structure, we have to have staff and so forth to be able to carry out our mission. And so, you know, maybe it's time to start moving away from that very direct service project oriented funding application and move it more towards recognizing some of those kinds of issues and how important they are. I can't say I've been overly successful, but I've tried, and I've at least put it out there. So, you know, and I'm sure others have too, but it certainly has been part of my discussion with some of our local funders.
Just being able to kind of identify opportunities has been one of the things that has tied our hands. And so being able to advocate for just who they are. You say these young people, 16 to 24, who've dropped out of school and are disconnected from work, you suddenly see the young boy hanging on the corner with his pants swinging down. But in reality, you know, I might be advocating for a young person who graduated high school and just can't figure out what those next steps look like. So to be able to have funding that supports that person, an Opportunity Youth could be a 29, 30 year old person with a family, but my funding says that I must see this person 5 days a week. Well, what young parent can do that? And so we find ourselves advocating for the language in those RFPs, as you mentioned earlier, Jill, just to be changed to support who these young people are, because we're not describing them, and none of the language in the RFP that we recognize describes these young people.
Yeah. I know one of the things
to see by testimony. Advertising.
One of the things that Greg brought up is this hollowing out of government. And we've taken what used to be a lot of public services and turned them over into contracts or grants or crazy arrangements. And we certainly saw that in the last budget crisis when organizations were not getting paid. You know, for you guys, when you think about government contracts, one of them is program, kind of restricting what they'll fund for program. But anything else that you see from the government contract side that would free up some more of those monies? If you were sitting across from a government official and they said, okay, if we could change one thing in our funding relationship to you, would it just be releasing those program dollars into more unrestricted, or are there other things that you can think of that would help with that?
Well, I would say that, as Sandra had said, that would be a really big help. Sandra, I have a little bit of work history in the world of contracting with DCFS. It's not my current world, but my experience in association there with agency leaders is that if they could just reduce the unnecessary duplication of certain reporting requirements, they could probably add 20 to 30% program value into their work. Mm-hmm. So, and there have been some really good efforts to work that forward. It's a long haul because it's very granular, and you have to move a whole lot of policies and systems over an extended period of time, even to remove one or two reports. Once they've built up in that system, it's really difficult to pull them back out.
But as a researcher, I always wanted to know, like, can I see those reports? Because they seem to be like someone gets them, they go into a filing cabinet or a digital file, and no one sees them ever again. I'm like, that'd be great research, like, to get those final reports. That's not easy either. Getting them out isn't, I know getting them in is hard. Getting them out to the outside public. So like, why are we doing it then? If the public can't actually see them, how does that increase accountability?
If I might, Alicia, this is a little different twist to that question. That what I'm so encouraged by is that we do see interest from elected officials, congresspeople, trustees in DuPage. It would be the county board. We're kind of DuPage centric, but we're now serving the entire region. And I am excited about the desire to listen. So wherever we can build relationships that fit our program, where we're bringing those representatives into our world to meet and listen, it does not need to be discussion of specific legislation, although we do that too. But if we can equip them with just an understanding of the lives of our constituents and clients, they're much more inclined to do the right thing when their multitude of options come forward. And I'm sensing an openness to that, and that bodes well for the future.
So each of you are in a different county. DuPage, DeKalb, and Kane. From DeKalb and Kane perspective, are we at the same place as DuPage County? Do you guys feel that in your respective counties? Jill, I don't know your thoughts on DeKalb County.
If you're referencing our connections and the ability and desire of local officials towards the nonprofit community, I think we have a very healthy relationship in this county. I know I personally feel that way. I feel like I can approach officials at any level, whether it be, local municipalities or the county board or, the county executives or anything like that, our local state reps, et cetera. So I think it's a healthy relationship. I think it could be better just simply from the standpoint of having the opportunity to do more things like Dave was mentioning earlier, having the opportunities to connect and get together more often than we do. Some of that, again, is driven by the fact that when you're a small organization with small staffs, there's only so many hours of the day. And, these are all in your to-do lists or your goals for the year. And somehow the year comes to the end and you don't necessarily get it done. But overall, I agree. I think that they are very responsive to the nonprofit community and are more than happy to listen and to be educated and take that into some of their decision-making processes. So here in DeKalb County, I feel like we're in a very positive relationship.
Sandra, anything would you agree?
I'm feeling the exact same about Kane. Very positive relationship, very open to government. Literally have the state representatives that kind of reach out for our input. The city is hosting listening sessions and kind of bringing nonprofit leadership into that, bringing residents in to just, I think the pandemic has kind of put us all in this one space that kind of shook us and said, hey, what are we looking at here? And let's get everybody's voice at the table to figure out what we're looking at and how best to solve these problems. So yeah, I think we have a very great relationship with Kane County.
With crisis brings opportunity, right?
With crisis brings opportunity, absolutely.
That we're all in this together.
They've been very responsive to that, so yeah.
Well, I don't want to ignore any questions from any of the participants that are still with us. So if anyone has a question, please pop it into the chat because we can certainly, we have a couple of minutes left before people have to head out for lunch and other things to get going. So if anybody does have a question, please pop it in there and we'll make sure that we can ask the participants, or you could ask it yourself if you want me to open up your mic. We have about 10 minutes left. Anything from the three of you that we did not discuss that you wanted to make sure that you you shared with us today from Dave, Jill, or Sandra?
Just had a little cute story about internal school advocacy. One of our first families and Light kind of parachuted into Aurora about 6 years ago as a small nonprofit talking about dealing with disconnected youth who had fallen through the cracks. And one of the stories that we met was a young family that was struggling and had a high schooler who was about to drop out of high school. He was literally convinced he was going to drop out. And what we found is in supporting the mother just at a school local level and helping her to understand his IEP and being able to bring forth the language to get him into a smaller school setting made the world of difference for that family. So advocating for that family just at that local level inside of a school actually got that family graduated by the end of the year.
Right. So we haven't, yeah, that's true. We didn't specifically mention how do you advocate at that very, at the very individual level. Yeah. Jill, did you want to add something?
Well, I think, you know, the whole concept of advocacy, and again, we're, the two of us are especially in that category. You know, there was a case involving a young man who, you know, came into the system when he was 7 and was, you know, removed from his home because his mother had severe drug issues and so forth. And it was a long involved case. And he had the same CASA advocate throughout the whole process. And he once the case was finally resolved and he eventually was adopted by his foster family, he wrote a nice letter to our advocate and he said to her, "You always have my back." You know, it reminds you how advocacy at that very one-on-one level, how somebody speaking up can make such a huge difference. I mean, that's a heart clutcher story because that's involving a child who was severely neglected and you know had to go through a lot of things at a young age. But I think you can take that and just spin it at a continuous level. You know, all it takes is one person or one entity to advocate for another person or another entity and how it can make such a world of difference in their lives. And I think that's always what we have to remind ourselves, whether we're advocating on a local level, a state level, or a national level, is you truly can make that difference. And that's why advocacy is so important.
Absolutely.
That's great, Jill. And I think that's when Sandra mentioned, you know, collective impact and outcomes, a lot of the work that you guys do isn't necessarily realized today. It's right. Realized 5 years from now and the next generation. And so that's really hard to do this advocacy work, knowing that you may not reap those rewards for a certain amount of time, especially with populations that you're not tracking over time. You don't know where they go, but that work, you know, has that big long lasting impact. So that's amazing. Good story. All right. Well, I don't see any further questions. Dave, did you want to add something?
Yeah. Sure. I would just extend a warm invitation to everybody who's on the call to Human Services Information Sharing Gathering that we've been hosting on a monthly basis. It's focused on reducing isolation for human services in the days of COVID, sharing resources, learning from each other. It's evolved over time. Yesterday, we did a visit on preserving safe shelter. We talked about eviction prevention. Prairie State Legal was there. They serve the region that we're in. DuPage Pads was there. They're presenting what is kind of a new vision for how we work in a world that doesn't have congregate shelter. So we're DuPage centric. 75% of the folks on the call were from DuPage, but because the issues are regional and statewide, the other 25% were Cook, Lake, Kane. So you can look at each of the subject matters and decide if it's going to be a value to you to sit in. It's essentially a bit of a panel, and then it's a round table to hear from people what's working and not working for them. And I've put my email into the chat. So if you'd like to get onto the invitation list for that meeting, please just drop me a line and I'll put you on the invitation for the next one.
You know, as we wrap up, one of the things I'm curious about, how are your staff and the people that you know, the frontline nonprofit staff, how are they holding up? Because part of the group that we advocate for is also our own. And we don't always do a great job with that. I think they have, you know, very high stress right now, a lot of mental health anxiety, you know, but how are they holding up and how are you supporting your staff and the people that you work with right now?
Oh, wow, that's a great question.
It's tough, I know.
You know, one of the things that we do at Light is just leave room to talk. I literally have a standing 1 hour on my calendar every Friday from noon to 1, just so that any of our staff can kind of pop in and just be, just talk about a particular case or what they are going through or something that is impacting the community or all of us, you know, and just being there for them and offering an opportunity to vent, if you will, or to find creative solutions for other things that might be going on that are impacting their work has been very helpful.
Yeah.
Yeah, we have a standing morning staff meeting, but we always start out the morning by just kind of casually visiting with each other because we're a very close staff. Again, when you're a staff of five, you know, develop, and we've all been together for a number of years. So you develop that relationship. It's harder to maintain those connections when you're all working remotely, but we've always made sure that a portion of our meeting is devoted to that. And then I always make sure that my staff knows that I'm always available no matter what. Then we also have a volunteer base because our advocates are actually volunteers. And so we do the same thing. We make sure that that the advocate supervisors for those volunteers are checking in on a regular basis, not just to talk about the cases that they're on, but to literally just say, you know, how's it going? How was your holidays? You know, what's going on? That kind of thing. So we've tried to be very conscious of that, particularly during this time of COVID and the pandemic shutdowns that have, you know, ensued and everybody feeling so isolated. So it's not perfect, but we are trying.
Dave, any thoughts there?
Sure. So we serve organizations and our core identity is as a planning council. We have a council of 34 community leaders and they're multi-sector, human services and beyond. And on a quarterly basis, they take the most difficult issue and kind of dig into it. But in the last 10 months, two out of their three meetings, they've set aside the question of a specific policy issue and instead said, how are you dealing with the transition to each other? And we have featured some presenters who are able to help provide tools and guidance for that discussion. And I'm looking at Jill and Sandra who are doing this for their teams. So for us, imagine a room full of Jill and Sandra's who are having the chance to say, you won't believe how this is going here. Or you won't believe how difficult this is here. Do you have a sense that I think that one third of my staff are just about ready to walk out that door and never come back? That's a place where we've been able to be helpful, I think.
Thank you. And Dr. Greg Kuhn is back. He came back for the final wrap up. You can turn your mic on if you want to chat.
Yeah, no, I've been listening and I've been learning as well. So thank you all. It's interesting because many of the things you touched on, you know, I've also had a chance to teach public policy classes. And Alicia, that is exact definition that I want to make sure students leave with is policy is anything government decides to do or not to do. Yeah. And either one of those sides is important. But to this last topic, I'll just leave you with this thought because I started out talking about government. And I know that there aren't many parades very often for government and staff because remember, all those agencies, all those offices are filled with people that are trying to do their best. But I guess one of the things that I learned early in my career that was given to me by one of my mentors and I've shared is, and I think it applies to your industry too, is when things are at their worst, government has to be at its best. That's why we're here. That's what people ask us to do. And whether it's a disaster, an event, something in your house, your family, your neighborhood, those are the days you really have to step up. And it comes, you know, through a lot of dedication, through people that are willing to do this work. And so, yes, people get paychecks for everybody that's on this call, but you have to have some of the mission in here too. Yep. Otherwise, there's a lot of other choices people can make. So I just want to thank you all for everything you do. And Alicia, thanks for letting me tune in. And I enjoyed it all. I've been here listening quite closely. So I wish everybody well.
Yeah, I want to thank all of our panelists today. Greg, for kicking us off with a good overview in an hour and 25 minutes, United States history of government. So we're going to put this up on our YouTube. People can go back and check it out. But this is such important work that all of you are doing. And I'm grateful that you shared your experiences for this conversation. And thank you all for attending. Really appreciate it.
Alicia, you're the best moderator ever.